Welcome to Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium in Suwanee, Georgia. It's the Georgia High School Association 7A semifinals tonight. The McEachern Indians take on the North Gwinnett Bulldogs for a spot in the state championship game next week at Mercedes-Benz Stadium. And good evening. I'm Matt Stewart, joined by Tommy Palmer and Tommy. McEachern seeking their first state championship game appearance since 1998. But they've been down this road before. This is the third time they've been in the semifinals in the last 5 years. But this one is unexpected. This was supposed to be a rebuilding year, part of the rebuild, replacing four-year starting quarterback, coach's son, Bailey Hockman, who's now at Florida State. And they've done it with three quarterbacks, one of them a freshman, Carlos Del Rio Wilson, also Malik Evans and Isaiah Lee.
It's amazing that you get to game 14 and you still haven't settled on a quarterback. You use three quarterbacks and one of them a freshman, which is dangerous territory for many coaches. But obviously, he's the right guy to start the game.
Yeah, haven't settled on a quarterback, but they've still won 10 games. That's amazing, too. Now, North Gwinnett in the semifinals for the third time ever. Both times they were able to win and advance to the state championship game. But this was also unexpected for the Bulldogs after the departure of longtime head coach Bob Speier, replaced by Bill Stewart, who came from Mill Creek, where he had been the defensive coordinator. First-year coach here, but a veteran head coach himself. And there's no doubt what they want to do tonight. They want to give the ball to Tyler Goodson.
Run the ball. And by the way, run the ball. Tyler Goodson's a good one. He's the one that got you here. Don't change what you're doing. This is game 14. You've won 12 in a row. Keep doing what you're doing. It's paid dividends.
It has indeed. And the junior running back has rushed for close to 1,200 yards and 18 touchdowns, averaging over 7 yards per carry. Now, the third member of our team tonight is Sam Crenshaw, and he's on the sidelines.
Spent some time talking with Coach Kyle Hockman from McEachern this week. And if a loss can motivate a team, maybe that's the case for this McEachern team. The final game of the regular season, a bitter defeat to neighborhood rival Hillgrove. It's the first time that the Hillgrove seniors had ever beaten McEachern. I mean, in high school, middle school, or even in Pop Warner ball. A bitter defeat for this team, and he knew what it meant to his football team. Hockman rallied his team in a tight circle after the game. Didn't want infighting, didn't want finger pointing. He said, don't bend, don't break. Turn the page. They did not watch the tape of that game. He changed his hat and changed his shoes. They turned the page, and here they are, a win away from going to the state championship game.
All right, thank you, Sam. North Gwinnett getting ready to take the field under their first-year head coach, Bill Stewart. Won 12 straight since a 31-28 season-opening loss versus Walton in the Corky Kell Classic. And Tommy, Coach Stewart says they've had to fight through adversity all year. They have not gone through a big game this season where they were not missing somebody, and that is the case again tonight. Their starting defensive tackle, Knox Denny, not available after being ejected in the quarterfinal win last week.
What an unusual thing to happen to this football team. But you know what? They've overcome adversity all year long. Nobody had North Gwinnett penciled in the semifinals when we started the season. They lost their coach, got a new coach. This is a good football team. As I said early on, Matt, keep doing what you're doing. Even though you're minus a player or two, just keep doing what got you here. 12-1. That's a pretty stout football team.
And Bill Stewart's team lost their star quarterback, Cade Fortin, who's committed to Texas A&M. He broke his leg in the second game of the season against Milton, and they still were able to win 12 games in a row behind the backup, Jimmy Urzua, a senior whose brother was a star quarterback here.
Yep.
Johnny, who graduated and signed with Middle Tennessee.
It's amazing. And they can do it. This team can play some football. Take a look at what they did. North Gwinnett, here's their playoff appearances.
They've been in the finals twice. They're trying to get back there for a third time. Lost to region rival Norcross in 2013. Got there the first time in 2007 when they lost to Lowndes. And all of those under Bob Speier, who's now the head coach at Camden County. McEachern, last five seasons, they've been in the semifinals twice in 2013 and 2014 under the aforementioned Bailey Hockman. Opening kickoff is brought to you by HeadsUpGeorgia.com. Heads Up Georgia, the opening kickoff. And we are underway, a pooch kick that's going to be taken at the 36-yard line by McEachern after North Gwinnett had won the opening toss and deferred to the second half. And we have a flag down on the field as well to start the game.
Opening game jitters. We're going to have a little of that, Matt, before everybody gets settled in a little bit here.
We might have an offsides or a legal procedure. Actually have a delay of game on McEachern.
Wow. Keith Hammond, your referee tonight. Rob Underwood, Davis Thurman, Derek Willis, Rex Wade, Antonio Smith, and Stephen Bailey.
So the Indians will get the ball. Let's see where they mark it off from the 35. It should be a 5-yard penalty. So the 30-yard line is where McEachern will start tonight, with their freshman quarterback, Carlos Del Rio Wilson, 6'2", 205 freshman. He's thrown for 736 yards, 5 touchdowns, and 4 interceptions.
Not your typical freshman, 6'2", 205.
He is more of their passing quarterback. Going to hand off to Paris Brown on the very first snap. Paris Brown with the cutback, and Paris Brown picks up 3 yards to the 33-yard line. As we take a look at the McEachern Indians on offense, take a look at the right guard, Alex Grant. That's right, 6'3", 377 senior.
I purposely asked if he pulled the guards, and he said yes. Watch him. He can get out there. How much? 377?
And Paris Brown, the running back, with 1,116 yards rushing this season. Second down and 7. Del Rio Wilson going to fire, and it's off the hands of his intended target, Brandon Christie, and it's going to be third down as we take a look at the Bulldogs on defense. Payne Walker, the bandit, 6'2", 240 senior, the leader up there. Jake Stewart, the Mike linebacker, is the coach's son. Came with him from Mill Creek High School. And in the secondary, a couple of D1 prospects. DJ Turner, the number 24-rated cornerback in the class of 2019. He plays free safety for the Bulldogs. Warren Burrell, also a D1 prospect at cornerback.
And they're not heavy, but they're cat quick.
Pocket for Del Rio Wilson. He's going to fire and overthrow Jerron Hall. And it's going to be fourth down, a 3-and-out for McEachern to start this game.
Not a lot of open spaces in the secondary out there, Matt. Good coverage that time by North Gwinnett.
DJ Turner and Jabani Cunningham standing deep for the Bulldogs. And Jeremiah Folks will punt for the Indians from the 18-yard line. Got a heavy rush on it. Short kick, fair catch is going to be bobbled at the 38-yard line. The Indians are on top of it.
Ill-advised fair catch.
Jabani Cunningham called a fair catch, never really got under the football, hit off his fingertips, and McEachern recovers in Bulldogs territory.
A lot of white jerseys and blue and yellow pants around him there. Dangerous territory to be fielding a football there.
Well, the problem was he called a fair catch, so he can't be hit. He just short-armed the ball. He gave it alligator arms, really. Yeah. He had to get under the football, and he never did.
True.
So a big mistake for the Bulldogs as the Indians take over at the 38-yard line.
First turnover goes to McEachern.
Malik Evans in there at quarterback. Paris Brown trying to get away from DJ Turner. You saw great pursuit by Turner, who drags him down for a 2-yard loss.
Boy, excellent pursuit by the corner over there. My goodness, look at this guy run on defense. Knew right where to go, when to get there. Excellent tackle in the open space as well.
DJ Turner has 24 offers already. Clemson, Auburn, Michigan, and Alabama among those. Recently told reporters after a visit to Ann Arbor that the Wolverines were among his top programs.
Wow. Paris Brown. No running room for Brown. I think he got dropped for a yard loss right there. They went to the right defensive tackle. Obviously, the replacement is up to the task tonight. McEachern checking him out on the first series of downs here.
And you saw number 55, Warren Erickson, who's the number 5 rated center in the country, playing defensive line on that play and in on the tackle, and it's third down and long.
And he'll be back out there shortly, I'm sure. 13 yards to go. Malik Evans in at quarterback.
False start. Offense. 5-yard penalty.
Cadence.
Third down.
Changing quarterbacks. That's one of the things. Their cadence, no matter if you call everything the same, if the cadence is different, they hear it different, Matt.
No doubt about it. Backs him up 5 yards, so now it's going to be third down and 18.
18 yards to go.
You saw Kyle Hockman wearing his Bruce Arians cap over there on the sideline, looking resplendent in his McEachern blue and gold.
I'm telling you. He's got that hat, doesn't he?
Evans hands off. Big hole for Paris Brown. A cutback for Brown. He's going to be brought down at the 35-yard line. Jake Stewart in on that tackle for the Bulldogs. It's going to be fourth down, and they're probably going to go for it here because they don't really have a kicker to make it from this distance.
Wide hole on the right side. 377 obviously opened the gates there.
That was a 10-yard pickup and a man down for the Bulldogs at the point of the tackle, the 36-yard line.
Wow.
Let's check in with John Nelton. He'll be keeping up with the semifinal scores across the state tonight.
Bonus coverage, guys. Barron Stadium in Rome. The replay of last year's 5A title game. Rome and Buford Wolves, and Wolves knocks Kadem on the play action, finding Xavier Roberts. 7 straight running plays, 5 different carriers. So what do? Pass it. 7-0. 8:47 to go in the first. Brookwood also leads by the score of 7-0 as well. Irwin County leading in single A. And the Harleys have led Lee County out onto their turf in Leesburg against Glen Academy back upstairs.
There you go. And that Rome and Buford matchup, a state championship caliber matchup here in the semifinals. That was Warren Burrell, the cornerback for the Bulldogs, and one of their top D1 prospects, just a junior, however, who was shaken up on the play. So now it's going to be fourth down and 9, and I'm guessing that the Indians will be going for it here from the 36-yard line.
Burrell, a little gippy coming off there. I don't know that I've ever seen a high school coach wear one of those.
It looks good.
Huh?
Not that he
very
needs my vote of
confidence.
Yeah, not that he needs my vote of confidence.
Yeah. Nor mine, but I've never seen one wear one of those before.
Malik Evans going to quick kick it. They're going to try to pin the Bulldogs deep. Nobody back, and they're going to be effective here as it rolls backwards, and it'll be down to the 9-yard line. So the Indians, rather than go for it on fourth down and 9, a 26-yard quick kick by Malik Evans, and that's going to pin the Bulldogs deep as they go on offense for the first time tonight.
Well, what we're seeing is a little infighting, a little sparring, jockeying for position, testing of what has been scripted offensively and defensively. The first 3 minutes of the game are past us now, so let's see what North Gwinnett can do with their first 3 minutes of possession.
Jimmy Urzua, the quarterback, took over second game of the season when Cade Fortin suffered a broken leg, and he's done a fabulous job passing for over 2,000 yards, 21 touchdowns, and just 4 interceptions. He fumbles the ball. McEachern's on top of it at the 6-yard line. My goodness. Twice the Bulldogs have touched the ball on a punt return and on their first snap from scrimmage, and both times they have fumbled the ball.
Little nerves here, Matt.
Well, it was going to be a read option here, and the quarterback, Urzua, I believe, was going to keep it rather than hand off to Goodson, and the ball just ended up falling on the ground and recovered by the Indians.
That's exactly what it was. Urzua was going to take it to the left side, fumbled the football, and couldn't get back to get it.
And Michael Fairbanks, the young man who's committed to UAB, who's played injured most of his high school career, comes up with a big fumble recovery at the 5-yard line. First and goal to go for the Indians.
Talk about good field position.
And now Paris Brown's going to run Wildcat, takes a direct snap, going to run it right up the middle, and Paris Brown gets shoved back at the four-yard line, picks up only 1 yard on the play.
Pretty stout defense that time, and the offensive center is back in there yet again, number 55 at defensive tackle.
Yeah, that's Warren Erickson, the young man who's committed to the University of Georgia, 6'4", 330 pounds. Second down and goal. Paris Brown again runs Wildcat. Right up the middle, touchdown.
Untouched.
Paris Brown takes it in from 4 yards out. McEachern capitalizes on the North Gwinnett fumble and takes the early 6-0 lead.
Wow. Not much of a drive, but very effective. Two fumble recoveries in the first 3 or 4 minutes of a ball game here.
Well, the two fumble recoveries led to that one touchdown. The fumble recovery gave them a short field. They quick kick down inside the 10. Would set him up to recover the next fumble and get the short 4 yard touchdown run.
North Gwinnett got to shore things up here early on. Gwinnett, North Gwinnett, definitely.
Ruben Rodriguez on for the PAT. He gets it through. And 4 minutes and 3 seconds into this ballgame, McEachern has taken a 7-0 lead on North Gwinnett. That was the fumble by Urzua, recovered by Fairbanks. And then just two plays later, Paris Brown on the Wildcat takes it right up the middle. And McEachern has the early lead here in Swanee.
When I was in high school, I wasn't sure what career path to follow. I was introduced to the pharmacy tech program at a technical college, and I love it. I have taken college courses in retail and hospital pharmacy at absolutely no cost to my family. I've discovered my passion, and I'm on my way to becoming a pharmacy technician.
Dual enrollment at Georgia's 22 technical colleges. Double the credit, half the time, zero the tuition. Learn more at doublethecredit.org.
If you text while driving, it's like turning the wheel over to your dear old grandpa, your nosy neighbor, your nephew. No, the younger one. And on top of everything else, it's against the law. Heads up, Georgia. Texting and driving is deadly on our roads. Put down the phone. Drive alert. Arrive alive.
As electric utility providers, Georgia's EMCs know how to generate and distribute electricity. But who are we really? We believe our brightest light shines from the cooperative principles we were founded on. Each day, Georgia's 41 EMCs provide safe, affordable, and reliable electricity to our members. But we serve our communities in additional ways, too. So whether you spot us around town or on your doorstep, know that your locally owned EMC is hard at work for you. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
Regions Bank is always looking for opportunities to help communities and individuals move forward. In addition to offering financial solutions to our customers, we're committed to supporting local initiatives and organizations that help our neighborhoods thrive. Regions is proud to partner with Georgia Public Broadcasting in building a better Georgia.
McEachern with the 7-0 lead on the North Gwinnett Bulldogs. Just 4 minutes into this ballgame, Tommy, two fumbles by the Bulldogs as we take a look at the TCSG touchdown replay. Set up this touchdown run by Paris Brown.
Definitely. Two fumbles. That'll kill you in any game. But in a playoff game of this magnitude, that really stings early on.
So McEachern has the early lead as they crossed town from Powder Springs to get to Swanee today. Favorable traffic today. It was not too bad in Atlanta, surprisingly enough.
For a Friday,
exactly.
I thought it was nice
it
today.
It really was.
You know?
Maybe a good omen for McEachern. It didn't take him long to get here. He said his kids were surprised. Ball is taken at the 22-yard line. And a big tackle at the 29-yard line by Justin Robertson.
Good coverage that time. It's amazing that these two schools wouldn't have outstanding kickers. They're pooch kicking. Both are pooch kicking now. So we're used to, in the playoffs here, we're used to seeing kids just drill it in the end zone, drill it in the end zone. You would think that both of these teams would have that.
But if you don't have that, the pooch kick is the better option rather than kick it deep and have a guy like Turner try to take it back on you.
I agree.
Toss goes to Goodson. They finally get a chance to give him the ball. That was the first play they punt on offense where they didn't fumble the ball. A 5-yard pickup by Goodson on that play right there as we take a look at the Bulldogs on offense. And there's the aforementioned Warren Erickson, the number 5 rated center in the country who's committed to Georgia. Tyler Goodson is really good. Close to 1,200 yards rushing this season, 18 touchdowns. Josh Downs, the slot back, number 11, has been their go-to wide receiver all season. They throw the ball to Goodson over here, coming to the near side. And Goodson spin move up to the 47-yard line. Nice play by Goodson. Wow. As he's tackled by Dwayne White, the corner, but a flag down after a 12-yard pickup.
I think we're going to have holding on the outside receiver.
There it is.
Yes. That's not a hold. That's an undress.
On the offense. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat.
The wide receiver got locked up on the Indians rover, Tony Davis.
Yeah.
That negates a 12-yard pickup and a first down. So rather than first and 10 from the 46, it's now second and 12, way back at the 26, or 27, I should say.
Need to get Goodson warmed up here, Matt.
They go empty backfield with Goodson lined up in the slot, and now he goes in motion. He'll take the handoff in a jet sweep. And Goodson, no running room that time, barely got back to the line of scrimmage. And that was the defensive end. Cameron Moon making the tackle as we take a look at the Indians on defense. And there he is, Moon making that tackle. Jamil Burrows is a sophomore who's already got offers from Georgia and South Carolina. We told you about Fairbanks. Dante Fleming's been their leading tackler this season by far, a 5'9", 205-pound fire plug. And in the secondary, Tony Davis, their rover, been really good. And so has his backup, Nazir Curry-Sudler, who we'll see play here tonight as well. Third down for the Bulldogs.
Heavy secondary, very big for McEachern.
Heavy rush, Fairbanks pushes the pocket. Ball is thrown incomplete. Manor was the target, and it's going to be fourth down.
Overshot him. Had a guy out there, but overshot him. I'm sure it's a little matter of North Gwinnett getting settled into this thing. You don't want to let it get out of hand here before you get settled in, though, Matt. They need to go to work.
Will Reichert is on to punt for the Bulldogs. Hull and Scott are deep for the Indians. Reichert, the senior, stands at his 14-yard line.
Wow.
They're going to set up a return here if they can. A line drive kick that bounces away from Scott. Nice roll. That was none executed very well by the Bulldogs to get a 44-yard kick out of it. Down by number 40 Cunningham. The weekend we've been waiting for is quickly approaching. Clear your schedules for December 8th and 9th as GPB's Football Fridays in Georgia covers the GHSA Football Championships in the new Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Will your team go all the way? We'll find out next week, Friday and Saturday, right here on GPB. First and 10, ball at the 28-yard line. Del Rio Wilson back in there at quarterback. They run Paris Brown to the short side. He's got no running room. The linebacker, Jake Stewart, comes up to make the play. We saw Jake Stewart last year as a junior at Mill Creek. And when Bill Stewart left Mill Creek as the DC to come here as the head coach, Shannon Jarvis said, "That's fine, Bill. You take the job, but Jake's got to stay." Jake ended up following his father for his senior year here at North Gwinnett.
Excellent, excellent pursuit that time by Stewart. Had it tagged the entire way. I tell you what, now in this four-man front and with the three linebackers, North Gwinnett's got to be real active. They just rolled somebody up on the defensive side over there to become a five front.
Play action, heavy rush, ball is thrown away and nearly intercepted. They will rule that an incomplete. Great rush came off the edge from Payne Walker, the bandit.
That's a freshman mistake there,
I think. That could have easily been a pick six interception for a defensive lineman right there.
Yeah, he'll get instructions from the sidelines on that one. That's heart attack stuff there.
Whoops.
Nope, can't do that.
As Payne Walker, who got the great penetration, watch him blow up the block right there. Actually, that was not Payne Walker that got the heavy rush. That was Jaden McDonald, who had the heavy rush, number eight, the Sam Backer. Third down, and the play gets blown dead. A timeout called from the sideline by Kyle Hockman.
I just think that was a freshman mistake. He's young. He's got to be 14. You have to go ahead and eat it right there. You do not throw it up in the air.
No doubt about it. It would be better to take an intentional grounding than to have an interception.
Exactly. And we almost saw an interception there.
And probably better or just as well to take the sack right there than the intentional grounding.
Exactly. Exactly. Boy, this guy, Alex Grant, I'd like for us to focus a little on him at 377. He is impressive at how he moves. 6'3", 277. Wow. Alex Grant, number 74.
Well, this is one of the first years they haven't had a bona fide D1 offensive lineman. In fact, seven straight years they've had a D1 signee on their offensive line. And Tommy, some of those years they had multiple D1 signees. Last year it was Jalen Jackson, the right tackle, who signed with Purdue. You see Alex Grant right there. If he can get into shape, he might have a chance to get some offers as well. Probably going to go the junior college route before going on to big-time college football.
He is a load.
Third down and long for the Indians. Del Rio Wilson fires, and it's broken up. Christie was the intended target. Quentin Newsom, the corner, on the coverage. And that's one of the things we talked about, Tommy, in the extra point, is winning the one-on-one battles at wide receiver. That time, North Gwinnett won it.
North Gwinnett won on that one. Excellent coverage by North Gwinnett out there.
Kyle Hockman knew that his wide receivers would not be running open and free in this ballgame against this secondary for North Gwinnett.
They are quick.
Folks is in there to punt. Line drive kick. Cunningham's going to let it hit in front of him this time, and it takes a McEachern bounce and rolls dead at the 28-yard line.
That's a good move after a fumble on a fair catch call. Run away from the ball.
45-yard kick for Folks. And so the Bulldogs go on offense here for the second time at their own 28-yard line. They have been bottled up in their own end so far in this first quarter, while McEachern has benefited from two turnovers to cash in and score a touchdown here.
Well, I can't wait to see him get Goodson warmed up here and run the ball a little bit. I want to see some of that. I think that's probably what they need to settle into.
Two carries, 6 yards so far for Goodson. That's his third carry of the night, and he runs right into a brick wall. Nothing doing right there. Cameron Moon on that tackle, along with Dante Fleming.
Boy, Cameron Moon is the smallest member of that front four up there, but he's the most active, too.
Short gain on the play.
Not much there, Matt.
About half a yard, second down and 9.5. You take a look at Dante Fleming, their leading tackler at 5'9", 205.
There's that big center in the middle.
How'd you like to get matched up on him?
No, thank you.
All 6'4", 330 of him. Hand off Jabani Cunningham. Cunningham trying to get to the edges. He's not going to get there.
Should have kept the traffic pattern that he already had. He should have turned it up rather than cutting outside. Speed caught up with him.
Good tackle there by the spur, number 27, Ishmael Bridges, who met him there and then just pushed him to the sideline.
There's the hole there.
See Bridges fight off the block from the wide receiver and then just ride him on out of bounds.
Yeah.
Ball's on the 33-yard line. Third down.
A
brings up third down and we'll call it five. They got to get to the 38. There's Warren Erickson. He'll be playing for the Georgia Bulldogs next year. Goodson comes to the near side, trying to clear the edge, and he's going to be close to a first down.
Goodson carries around the left.
As the tackle was made by Tony Davis, the corner, but Goodson was able to get to the 39 and move the sticks.
He moved the sticks. You just got to get this guy warmed up. You got to give it to him for a little bit. That sets up your other stuff. This football team's built around this guy right here, number five.
He rushed for close to 1,200 yards, Tommy, and he missed three games.
I know.
That's, with a spring toe.
Yeah.
First and 10, ball is at the 39. Urzua going to hand off to Goodson again. And Goodson, not much running room right there.
Goodson.
I believe that was Jamil Burrows, number 96, who made that tackle.
Burrows,
6'4", 288 sophomore for the McEachern Indians. He's been offered by Georgia and South Carolina already. He's just a 10th grader.
Isn't it amazing the age of these children playing this man's game here?
Second down. That's Josh Downs in motion for the Bulldogs. They haven't gone to him yet. Steady diet of Goodson. Still not a whole lot from that as Goodson gets dropped again by Burrows at the 44-yard line.
Obviously, Goodson and the quarterback are kind of right-handed, Matt. Everything's kind of led to the right. But the right side of the North Gwinnett line is having big problems moving the left side of the McEachern defense. There's pretty good warfare going on out there. And McEachern's rolling up more than a four-man front. It almost looks like a 6-2 if you take a look at it.
Third down and six. Let's see if they go towards Downs this time. Urzua throwing deep. He's got a man out there, incomplete. Javonte Cunningham was the target at the 20-yard line and broken up downfield by Ishmael Bridges, the linebacker.
Urzua can air this thing out. The arm is no problem. Good coverage that time.
By the linebacker, no less.
One-on-one, running step for step.
Now, we might add that Bridges played in the secondary last year. They moved him to that second line. He's kind of a spur, which is that hybrid linebacker defensive back position. So,
right.
Did a good job in coverage that time. They kick away from Hull, and it's going to bounce out of bounds at the 21-yard line, 36-yard kick. Final 1 minute and 31 seconds of this first quarter. McEachern on top 7-0 after a fumble at the 5-yard line and a 4-yard touchdown run by Paris Brown.
Just a lot of spurring and sparring going on, as we say, Matt.
Indians 10-3 on the season, Tommy. They finished 4-1 in Region 3-7A. The number two seed, they lost a chance to win the region title against Hillgrove the final week of the season. In fact, you heard Sam Crenshaw talking about that emotional loss for the Indians in their regular season finale. Again, Paris Brown. Very interesting. They've run a lot of wildcat here. They've got three quarterbacks, and they're using Paris Brown as a fourth.
So they got four now. Okay.
Man down for the Indians right now on the offensive line. That's Mark Bennett, their center.
5'11", 280, and a junior. This is a young McEachern football team,
yeah.
Matt.
Like we said in the opening of the show, this was supposed to be a rebuilding year for McEachern. They lost so many players, not to mention the coach's son, Bailey Hockman, who was a four-star quarterback, a four-year starter, signed with Florida State. And it was anticipated that McEachern would be kind of in a rebuilding phase this year. It appeared to be that way when they lost their first two games of the season against Mill Creek and Grayson, two state powers, no doubt about that. They then won seven in a row before losing to Hillgrove in the finale, and they've rattled off three straight wins here in the playoffs. Let's check back in with John Nelson.
All right, guys, here's your update from Barron Stadium. A Jamias Griffin fumble at the Rome 35 turns into this action, moving the pile inside the 5-yard line. Then Rome gives up a touchdown. So after dominating the first quarter, Buford now down 10-7, ECI leading 15-8. On the other side of our 7A bracket, Brookwood and Colquitt County guys tied at 7.
We kind of thought that may be what happens on the other side of the bracket.
And here's that touchdown by the Buford Wolves. McLaughlin, the freshman quarterback, going to dive into the corner of the end zone. And one of those two teams will be playing in the 5A state championship game next Friday. That'll be a 4:30 kickoff at Mercedes-Benz Stadium as the teammates for Mark Bennett helping him get off the field. Taylor Beck Hogan is the backup, a sophomore. Taylor Beck Hogan actually began the season in the Corky Kell Classic. He was the starting center. So I anticipate that 76 Taylor Beck Hogan will take over in that center spot. We'll wait and see if that's the case. It looks like that is the case.
In this situation, in this offense, this is not as simple as it seems to change centers.
You lose some size there, too. Beck Hogan is 30 pounds lighter than Bennett. Second down. Malik Evans now in there at quarterback, and Paris Brown finds the running room very slim at the line of scrimmage. Jaden McDonald with the tackle for the Bulldogs.
Running behind Big Grant there, 6'3", 375, 377 on the right-hand side of the line, running inside. You keep waiting for McEachern to hit something at the corners, to run something at the corners, maybe throw something down the middle of the field. North Gwinnett's kind of rolling things up defensively.
Paris Brown, 9 carries for 19 yards so far. Going to get it for a 10th time right here. Big gain for Paris Brown, and he's off to the races. Brown finally brought down across the 50-yard line at the 46.
Finally gashed him outside. Had to get outside to get some yardage there. Worked him in the middle, and then all of a sudden, they go outside. Good blocking on the left side over there.
27-yard pickup for Paris Brown, who picked up 19 yards on his first 9 carries. Gets 27 on carry number 10 to give the Indians a first down at the Bulldogs' 47-yard line. And that might have been the final play of the first quarter. 8 seconds on the clock as the Indians come to the line. I think they're going to let the clock wind on out, and they do. And that is the end of the first 15 minutes of play from Suwanee, Georgia.
When you pass that first line of defense, it gets real touchy down there.
We'll start the second quarter with the Indians on the Bulldogs' side of the 50 as Paris Brown and the Indians start to get cranked up here at Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium.
Is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
On the first day of college, I was already a sophomore. I earned 32 college credits through the dual enrollment program at my local technical college. Cool part is, they all transferred. I saved time, and I saved my parents a lot of money.
Dual enrollment at Georgia's 22 technical colleges. Double the credit, half the time, zero the tuition. Learn more at doublethecredit.org.
Georgia's EMCs are committed to more than power. We're committed to staying power. In our 80-year history as an anchor of the community, we've weathered good times and challenging times right here with you. And we continue to invest in programs that energize our communities through hands-on learning and charitable giving, helping the next generation rise above, speed ahead, and power on. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
With 3,300 members in Georgia, Local Union 72 is a growing resource for plumbing and mechanical workers with educational programs for those looking for a career. For over 125 years, union members have pursued the goals of safety and excellence while utilizing apprenticeship programs to advance the skills of plumbers, pipe fitters, welders, and HVAC technicians. Local Union 72, a proud sponsor of high school football on GPB.
We'll be right back.
This program on GPB is made possible in part by supporters of the Georgia High School Association, including the following.
Support for GPB comes from Georgia Farm Bureau Mutual Insurance. From front porches to back roads, down the street or around the block, Georgia Farm Bureau is there with the protection families need, whether it's home, auto or life insurance, or something more. Georgia Farm Bureau is dedicated to providing the right coverage to all the friends, families, and neighbors who make this state home. More at gfbinsurance.com. Georgia Farm Bureau. Always the home team.
Back in Suwanee, Georgia, as Terrell Owens would say, gets popcorn, although he wouldn't like this ball game. Back in Suwanee, Georgia, start of the second quarter, McEachern leading North Gwinnett 7-0, as Terrell Owens would say, get your popcorn, although he would not like this game, Tommy, because we have not had a pass completion yet.
The next pass completion will be the first for either team. Amazing.
So McEachern at the 47-yard line as we start the second quarter. They lead this one 7-0. Winner plays either Colquitt County or Brookwood in the state championship game next Saturday. Del Rio Wilson hums it down the field, and it's intercepted. What a catch.
Wow.
An incredible one-handed catch by D.J. Turner, and that's why he's one of the top-rated defensive backs in the junior class in the entire nation.
Wow, I've got chills. That is some kind of interception. Wow, let's take a look at this. Thank you, Mr. Turner.
How did he hold on to this thing? It, like, stuck to his hands like Spider-Man.
It was like dunking a basketball. He just grabbed it and held on to it. Watch this. Great athletic play by Turner. I think he climbed the receiver, didn't he, to get that one?
Incredible play by D.J. Turner to give the Bulldogs the ball back. Tyler Goodson tries to get unchained right here, and he rumbles up to the 23-yard line. Goodson. Tackled by Devin Hart, the linebacker.
Goodson got some blocking on the right side, and as is the case with most football teams, North Gwinnett looks as if they're a right-handed football team. They got to get Goodson warmed up.
Second down and one, 9-yard pickup for Goodson right there. He had started the second half with,
ooh,
or second quarter, with 6 carries for 16 yards. He'll pick up the first down right there with some tough yardage over here on the edge. Actually, that was Devin Crosby on the carry that time. Crosby getting his first carry of the night.
Wow. Good hit by McEachern right here. That one's going to sting a little tomorrow.
So Crosby stays in there. First and 10 for the Bulldogs from the 26-yard line. Play action. Pass is caught. Nope, drop. Maynard could not hold on to it at the 37-yard line.
Good call. Good defense by McEachern. Yanked it out of there. Boy, that guy right there can go bear hunting with a switch. Number one, he is a player.
Urzua put it right on the money, and Maynard should have come up with that one. Second down and 10.
Yeah.
Dwayne White on the coverage. White, number one for McEachern, offered by UMass, Western Carolina, Austin Peay, and West Georgia. Second down and 10. Direct snap goes to Goodson as they try the Wildcat a little bit. McEachern ran a lot of Wildcat in that first quarter, scored their touchdown on a Wildcat. Goodson gets 5 on the play, up to the 32, brings up 3rd down and 5.
He's probably averaging 35 carries a game, wouldn't you say, Matt?
Late in the season, he has been.
Yeah. He's been carrying the mail.
So ball to the 32, just underway here in the second quarter. Bulldogs get benefit of their first turnover with the interception by D.J. Turner. Now trying to convert a 3rd down here to keep the drive going. Urzua going up top. Got a man streaking down the middle. Incomplete. That was Cunningham, again, his target. Very interesting here, Tommy, that Josh Downs, who has the vast majority of their catches this year, he has not been targeted so far in this game. Number 11, Josh Downs. That was Cunningham again. Twice they've tried to go deep to Cunningham.
I don't think the deep is going to work until they establish the run game. They've got to throw short and run the football.
to establish something here offensively, I believe. Boy, that McEachern secondary is really athletic.
Results in the first down.
Pass interference on McEachern is going to bail out the Bulldogs right there and give them a first down at the 47-yard line. So they failed to convert on third down, but the penalty bails them out. And so now for the first time in this ballgame, North Gwinnett approaches midfield.
That had to be away from the pass that was thrown. Had to be holding on the other side of the ball.
Wildcat again for Goodson right up the middle. Goodson leg tackled there by Devin Hart as Goodson gets four on the play across the 50 down to the 49.
And Goodson's going to come out. Nope, he's going to go back in. He headed to the sidelines. Now he's moving back in.
They got Cameron Butler teamed up with him now in that backfield. Number 11, Josh Downs, lines up at the top of your screen, way up there at the 50-yard line. Let's see if they try to get him the ball. Very unusual. They have not gone his way yet in this game.
Strong safety rolls to the right. They've got him double covered up there.
And the play gets blown dead. A timeout called by North Gwinnett with 9:49 to play here in the first half.
Coach Stewart not happy.
Let's check in with John Nelson.
All right, updating your bonus coverage from Barron Stadium. 4:11 to go in the first half. Knox Kadem on the bark had led him to the 26-yard line. Winds up and fires. 19 yards. Xavier Roberts, another score. It's now 17-7, second quarter. Also on the board, Hapeville Charter and Heard County tied at 14. It is Brookwood leading Colquitt County in the other half of the 7A bracket, guys, by the score of 14-10. Glen Academy still leading in Leesburg as well.
Nelly, how many straight consecutive state championship game appearances do the Buford Wolves have? I thought it was like a 10, wasn't it?
Was what, 10 of 11 at one point, wasn't it?
Is it 10 of 11? I thought they had a decade's worth of consecutive state championship
appearances. I'm trying to remember that full screen that we had in last year's championship game that was up that had a lot of small numbers to the right of the dash when it came to wins and losses.
Well, I tell you what, they're in a battle tonight and trailing at Rome in the state semifinals. It's second down. Urzua goes back to Maynard. Nope, that's actually going to be L.J. Fisher with the catch.
That's the kind of passes they've got to throw here. Can't go for the whole ball of wax.
19-yard pickup to L.J. Fisher right there for the first down.
Excellent call that time. Good throw, good catch, good defense. You can't defend that.
Urzua's been on the money with his passes. He just hasn't gotten a lot of help from his wide receivers so far in this game. Hand off Goodson, streaking through the defense. Goodson runs out of bounds inside that 25-yard line at the 23. Actually, that was Cameron Butler with his first carry. So Butler gets his first carry of the ball game.
Boy, they got some athletes, don't they? This is just rule blocking. This is just everything pulling to the right. Everybody blocking, rule blocking. It's amazing to watch these big guys at 300, 295 just sweep one side to the other. They go right side yet again.
Look at Goodson with the cutback. Dancing through the defense and a spin move. Like Barry Sanders gets to the outside, a stop cut, and picks up another 5 yards. Fabulous run by Tyler Goodson.
Good blocking on the right side. Got a cutback, got a spin move that would make Michael Jordan proud. Watch this. All the blocking goes right. Goodson, left. Fake.
Wow.
Spin move. And still going.
I liked how he was able to slam on the brakes at the end of all that and still pick up another 5 yards.
Oh, that was a nice move right there. People were grabbing at midair, Matt.
Goodson right up the middle, bulls his way inside the 10-yard line down to the 7.
Ladies and gentlemen, watch as we saddle up number 5 and ride. Big 56, big 55. Plenty of room to run through there for young Mr. Goodson. He's breathing hard now. He's ready to go, Matt.
Second down and 3. Going to get the rock again. And the ball is in the air. It's recovered by McEachern.
Oh,
ball
no.
Popped right up into a defensive lineman's hands. And the Bulldogs have fumbled again.
Wow.
Jeffrey Clark, the nose tackle, was standing in the right place at the right time as the ball popped right out of Goodson's hands and into his. A flag down on the play afterwards as Clark, thinking he was in the NFL, spiked the ball. Yep. So that's going to be a penalty against McEachern.
Watch. Wow, just as stuck Burroughs, his hand in there, Burroughs.
Yeah, Jamil Burroughs pops the ball out of Goodson's hands, and Jeffrey Clark is in the right place at the right time. Now, if you follow the play all the way, you'll see as he runs off the field, he spikes the ball, and that's the unsportsmanlike penalty. And you can see he's getting a talking to over on the sideline. That'll work in the National Football League, but it won't work on Friday night.
No, not in any state in this union.
Yeah, he's excited. I mean, I would have spiked it too, yeah, for Pete's sake.
Yeah. I think it scared him as bad as anything. All of a sudden, he's looking to tackle somebody and the ball pops in his arms.
Exactly. They never let me hold this thing in practice.
I know it. I've never even touched it before.
So this is what the football feels like. Paris Brown on the run, and Brown up to about the 16-yard line.
Boy, that's good blocking up front by that McEachern front wall, too. Wow. They went left side this time and really got some good yardage on that left side.
Well, remember, Tommy, what Bill Stewart told us, that they've overcome adversity all season long. Well, the adversity that they've got to overcome in this game tonight is their own selves. They've committed three turnovers here in the first 17 minutes of the game.
Yep, rule blocking by the McEachern line. They're just sweeping everything to the left. There's a hole. Look out.
Paris Brown. DJ Turner finally gets him on the ground with some help from his buddies, but that's a big pickup up to the 36-yard line. 20-yard gain for Paris Brown.
Excellent blocking up front. Just, no, I could not. It's just rule blocking. Everybody sweeps to the left. Block the man in front of you. Move the person in front of you. And so, they're doing a heck of a job at that.
So Paris Brown comes out of the ballgame, and Jalen Thornton makes his first appearance. Malik Evans in the ballgame at quarterback, throws complete to Genuine Potts. Potts, their leading pass catcher this year with 28 catches and 5 touchdowns, makes his first reception of the game. It's good for 9 up to the 45.
Nobody will really care, but one of my favorite football names of all time, Genuine Potts, as a wide receiver.
He's genuine.
Yes, he is genuine.
He's got offers from West Virginia and Wake Forest and a bunch of Group of Five and FCS-type schools.
Yes. Nothing fancy up front, Matt, with the line of scrimmage. They're just rule blocking, sweeping, going right and left. There's no trickery with the line of scrimmage.
That's Jalen Thornton with the first down carry up to the 50. Jake Stewart making the tackle for the Bulldogs. But the Indians are once again on the North Gwinnett side of the 50.
Getting a good push up front from those guys up front with the hands on the ground.
I think a big question, Tommy, for this North Gwinnett team is how do they respond after shooting themselves in the foot, to use the old cliche, several times already in this ballgame. It seems like there's a little less life on that sideline than there was just a few minutes ago.
Got to get some help from their linebackers. They got to do some stunting. They've got to get an interception, a fumble themselves.
Play blown dead before Del Rio Wilson could hand off to Paris Brown, who was back in the game.
There doesn't seem to be a feeling of anxiousness by North Gwinnett. Obviously not, because they've played these kind of games. They play well from behind, but they got to stop, as you said, shooting themselves in the foot.
So McEachern calls a timeout there with a 1st and 10 at the 50-yard line. McEachern leading North Gwinnett 7-0. Bulldogs with 3 critical turnovers here in the first 18 minutes.
The Georgia Department of Agriculture, informing growers and the consuming public of new federal produce safety rules in Georgia. Full information about the new rules is available at georgiafarmsafety.com.
I remember in middle school where we were learning about ecology and the marshlands, and went down to Tybee Island and were wading in the marshes. I think through that I had teachers who just encouraged me, as well as like my fellow students, to go for it if those are things that you're interested in. So.
Hart EMC is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
Welcome back to Suwannee, Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium. McEachern leading North Gwinnett halfway through the second quarter by the score of 7-0. Some updates from around the state as to who is bound for the Bends. Hashtag bound, number four, the Bends. At the break, Marist leading St. Pius by the score of 13-7. Blessed Trinity leading Mary Persons down in Forsyth by the score of 14-0. That is a second quarter score. And also at the break, and this is not a typo, Raven County leading Brooks by the score of 7-5. Wildcats, Trojans in Tiger, guys.
How about that, Nelly? And remember on Football Fridays in Georgia, the Inside Edition this season, we asked the question, will Raven County be that first North Georgia team to break through and get to a state championship game? That remains to be seen. Scott with his first carry of the night gets thrown for a loss by Jaden McDonald.
Tell you what, this guy can play number eight. Watch this.
Yeah, McDonald's a good-looking player, 6'2", 10 senior.
He suffered
a concussion in that Milton game. That was a big turning point for them. After they lost their opener to Walton, they played Milton, a very good Milton team that made the playoffs. That was the game that Fortin broke his leg.
Right.
Jake Stewart, their middle linebacker, sprained ankle. McDonald got concussed in that game. They still found a way to win it. And Bill Stewart said, our team looked around at all the guys who got injured in that game, that Jimmy Urzua came off the bench, led us to the victory, converted some big fourth downs in the comeback win, and said, wow, we did all that. We did that together as a team. We can do this. And he said that was really a springboard to the 12-game winning streak that they brought into tonight's game.
It is definitely, definitely a springboard. McDonald is some kind of player. Number eight in your program. He's number one on that North Gwinnett defense. He's a headhunter.
Illegal formation. Kyle Hockman not happy with that call over on the sideline as that backs him up to the 43-yard line. That's Kyle Hockman, not Bruce Arians, over on the sideline for McEachern. Had a good time visiting with him as they got to the, got to the ballpark a little bit early here today. We had a chance to talk about, he's a very interesting man.
He is. He really is.
He's really at peace. At a comfort level of what he is as a man and as a football coach, and his job as a football coach as the pass completed the pods, looks at himself a lot like more than just a football coach. He's a leader of young men trying to mold these guys into something more than just football players. I think he does a great job.
Yeah, he's good, and he is also the offensive coordinator. He's the one that all the plays goes through, correct?
Absolutely. Played for his dad, the legendary Ken Hockman, who was a legendary high school football coach in Ohio, who's no doubt here at the game tonight as well. Del Rio Wilson fires to the sideline, incomplete.
Good coverage out there by North Gwinnett in the secondary.
Terry Thomas was the target. Fourth down.
Excellent defensive set that time by North Gwinnett. They got some things done. McDonald made a good tackle on first down, and then, of course, the illegal formation by McEachern helped them a lot.
North Gwinnett not buying that McEachern's going to punt here. They did quick kick earlier with Malik Evans, and he's back out there, and he's going to do it again. The first time it led to a touchdown as the ball was downed inside the 10 and unable to save it this time. The first time they did it, it was down at the 5, and then on the next play, North Gwinnett coughed it up for the only touchdown, a short run by Paris Brown 2 plays later. That was a 47-yard kick, but a net of 27 as they'll bring it out to the 20.
It's going to take some work now for North Gwinnett here on offense. Can't make any more mistakes, need to drive and score and eat up the rest of the clock. It's only 4:03 left in what has been a very quick first half of play.
Well, North Gwinnett, I mean, I would think that they have confidence offensively. They were moving the ball well on their last drive until the fumble by Goodson.
So right.
I think they have confidence that they can move the ball. Do they have confidence that they can hold on to it long enough to get it in the end zone?
Exactly.
That's complete to Goodson. Goodson crashing tackle at the 29-yard line. That was a vicious hit.
Might be targeting here, Matt.
I thought it was clean. I think we're going to have a face mask is what we'll have. Ishmael Bridges was in on that tackle. I think Okwu, yep. Orenzi Okwu, number 21, came up there and delivered a great blow low to help get him on the ground. Watch 21 here.
Wow. He grabbed the face helmet, face mask, and everything.
On the defense. 5-yard penalty.
Yeah.
Results in a first down.
So it'll be a first down at the 34-yard line because of the penalty.
You understand why we like Goodson. He just does so many things. He is so quick.
Six penalties, 40 yards worth of penalties for McEachern so far in this game. Urzua throws complete out here to Devin Crosby. Nice form tackle by Dante Fleming right there. Grabbed him by the legs and just tied up the ankles and got him on the ground.
Thing that amazes me is how many teams in high school, if you'll watch them, they prefer to go short side to the weak side of the short side, short side, short side. I think we're going to see a bomb coming here, maybe a fake and a deep throw.
Crosby goes in motion, now sets the side Urzua. Going to take a handoff, and Burroughs is there, and Fairbanks. Wow. You saw the strength of number 58, Michael Fairbanks, on that play.
Wow.
That was kind of like a Greco-Roman move right there. That was all upper body, just wrestled him to the ground.
Yeah, just how do you like me now? Look at this.
Watch it. This is like a Greco-Roman. That's all upper body.
Just grab him, pull him down.
Third down. Four to the line of the game, the 39.
Intensity at
or the
both
44
lines of scrimmage. Yes.
And a timeout called by the Bulldogs to beat the play clock that had wound down to three.
Having trouble getting the plays in, obviously.
Stay connected to your team and every high school football team with the GPB Sports Football app. Now you can watch tonight's games live wherever you are. Get the latest news, find stats and matchups, and take interactive 3D tours of stadiums around the state. Tweet game highlights and get up-to-the-minute scores all Friday night. Download the free GPB Sports Football app from the iTunes App Store now. It's a must-have if you're a big high school football fan. And I'm guessing if you're watching us tonight, you are.
I would hope, wouldn't you?
So third down and four with the ball at the 40-yard line. We're down to 3:01 to play here in the first half. McEachern leading North Gwinnett 7-0. You know, all things considered, you know, it's about putting the right spin on this thing. All things considered for North Gwinnett, they've got to feel fortunate to be down only 7-0 with their three turnovers.
And they were key turnovers.
Goodson going to flip it back to Cunningham. Cunningham got a block across the 50. Giovanni Cunningham across the 30, the 20, and Cunningham finally on the ground at the 15-yard line. Jeremiah Folks, the corner downfield, saved the touchdown.
The old double reverse. My goodness. Haven't seen that one in a while.
46-yard pickup for Giovanni Cunningham. And now the Bulldogs inside the 15-yard line. Handoff, Crosby, and Fairbanks bear hugs him.
Again. Wow, Fairbanks gone to work, hasn't he? 6'3", 260.
Man, this is a great kid. I don't know if you heard us talking about him in the all-access pass show. He's committed to UAB. He's got a 4.0 GPA, plays in the orchestra. Chose UAB because he wants to be a mechanical engineer. Real bright kid. And a good football player, too. Urzua going to the air for the end zone. And Fisher the target. And a flag, was it dropped? Yeah, flag dropped. That's going to be pass interference. I believe we'll have a holding here on Dwayne White, number one for McEachern.
There was separation, and it all of a sudden dissipated. And you can see it when you see this. Somebody was grabbing somebody there. And there's our number one.
On a defense. Penalized half the distance to the goal. Second down.
Second down, pardon me. The automatic first down is an NFL rule. It's not in high school.
Ball is playing inside the 10-yard line.
Well, I don't know. You can maybe could have called Fisher for kind of pushing off there while the ball was in the air, too. There was combat, a lot of hand-to-hand combat going on down the field.
Yeah, a lot.
Second down. Keeper Urzua wide open, touchdown, and North Gwinnett's on the board with 2 minutes to play here in the first half. 7-yard touchdown run by Jimmy Urzua.
Excellent call at just the right moment. 2 minutes to go in the half, and what a great time for North Gwinnett to get on the board.
Cameron Clark is on for the PAT. Six plays, 80 yards, just over 2 minutes. The big 46-yard run by Cunningham was the one that set it up. Cameron Clark pumps it through. We're tied at seven. Here's your TCSG touchdown replay on the 7-yard run by Jimmy Urzua.
Just a regular spread option quarterback keep there. But, boy, you talking about a hole at the left side of the line. The line of scrimmage went right. He read the defense. There was no one home, Matt.
That was actually the second time they've run that play, Tommy. The first time they ran it was the fumble.
Yes, it was.
Hit the 5-yard line. This time they run it for a touchdown.
Exactly. Exactly.
And here was the reverse. Beautifully set up here. They gave the ball going one way with Goodson, and then Cunningham came back the other way and had some blockers downfield. He had offensive linemen downfield.
Did you see those big guys down there? The big uglies downfield blocking.
Getting the job done. That was the 46-yard run by Cunningham. That set up the 7-yard touchdown run by number seven. And we're tied at seven.
Sometimes it takes a little trickery, Matt, to get things going.
Yeah, it does. I mean, and it was set up very well, play called very well by North Gwinnett, their offensive coordinator, Steven Jackson. And now they're going to go back and look at it right there.
Thing I like was what they did with the offensive line to make it look like five was going to get just Goodson was going to get just another carry on it. And boy, did they fool everybody when Goodson flipped that thing in midair to that wide receiver coming back, going down the right side.
Jordan Simmons, number 22. First time we've called his name. He's back there to take this kick. He's a sophomore running back. He's not going to get a chance as they pooch kick. It's caught at the 38-yard line. And instead of fair catching the ball, he's going to try to run it.
North Gwinnett almost caught that thing in midair.
That was Nikoi Morris who caught it for McEachern. He was thinking about returning that thing.
Yeah, he was. He didn't notice that he had company in hot pursuit right there either.
Now, here's, you know, I get kind of caught in the middle here on the pooch kick thing. I mean, I understand the concept of it, but you give them the ball at the 44-yard line, how much worse would it have been if you'd kicked it deep? I know you risk the touchdown return if you kick it deep, but
it could be no worse.
Wow. Handoff goes to Paris Brown, runs into a man, and then Jaden McDonald gets him on the ground at the 48-yard line. A pickup of four on the play. I mean, if you kick the ball deep inside the 10-yard line, what are the chances they bring it back to the 44? I know it does open up the door for the possible touchdown, but now you've given McEachern a short field to work with and plenty of time still on the clock, and they have, I believe, well, the scoreboard says they have three timeouts remaining. I don't think that's right.
So. No, it's not.
And I know it's not right. So second down. Handoff right up the middle. Big hole. Off to the races. Paris Brown. And Paris Brown finally brought down at the 13-yard line. And there is the danger of giving them the short field to work with. A 39-yard run by Paris Brown has given him a chance to get another touchdown on the board here before the end of the half.
Rule blocking once more. Just the old sweep blocking. It looked like the Iowa line of scrimmage, the way they all go the same way and just cut back. Boy, Brown was wide open. He got a good block up front.
Brown now with 118 yards rushing in this first half. Del Rio Wilson going to hand off to him again. And the play got blown dead.
Make no mistake about it, though. McDonald, number eight for North Gwinnett, has been in hot pursuit of the running back every time he touches the football.
meet at the running backs.
So a 5-yard backup here for the Indians makes it first and 15 from the 19.
And time is an issue now. 1:12 left.
McEachern has two timeouts remaining, however, so still this is manageable for him.
Sure.
Del Rio Wilson rolling. Heavy rush. Fires to the outside. It's intercepted at the 12-yard line. Still on his feet. And across the 50, the young freshman Del Rio Wilson makes another big mistake. Quentin Newsom with the pick. And now the Bulldogs have it on the Indian side of the 50.
The only question is, why not cut back inside? You had blockers in front.
Yeah, Del Rio Wilson has made a couple of really big mistakes in this ball game. The first one didn't hurt him. This one potentially does very bad. 51-yard interception returned by Quentin Newsom as he picked the ball at the 11-yard line and returns it to the 47.
As much as has gone wrong for North Gwinnett, they've had a couple of really good things happen to them here lately.
Let's see if they take a shot right here. They still haven't gone to number 11, Josh Downs, yet. Keeper by Urzua. Urzua slides down at the 37-yard line. He's close to a first down.
That portion of the spread option has been open all night long, Matt.
North Gwinnett has one timeout remaining. They likely probably save that to try to set up a field goal attempt if it comes to that. Urzua, heavy rush, fires to the outside. It's caught on the sideline, out of bounds for a catch. First time they've been able to get the ball to Josh Downs, and that'll move the chains. It's a first down.
Let's see if they go for pay dirt here to Downs. Good pattern out there.
Yeah, he didn't get out of bounds, though, and they stopped the clock to move the chains. Now the clock's running again. Down to 26 seconds. They're going to have to move quickly here. Maybe time for two more plays. Urzua rushed, in trouble, can't take a sack, and he does. Back at the 36-yard line. And do they call a timeout here? They have to call a timeout with 14 seconds left, and Fairbanks got him. Urzua just simply could not take a sack there, and he did as Banks got to him.
Yeah.
Fairbanks got to him for his eighth sack of the season.
Wow.
Huge play by Michael Fairbanks again.
A key play for McEachern defensively there. Fairbanks just was in the right place at the right time. Three linemen out there for North Gwinnett, and they could not handle Mr. Fairbanks.
Well, and great coverage downfield because Urzua could not find anybody open. Cameron Clark warming up on the sideline. This is likely out of his range right here. This is a 52-yarder. Now, the problem is you've burned your last time out, which means if you throw the ball in the middle of the field, you're likely going to run out of time unless you're able to hustle up there and spike it real quick. And remember, the clock will stop if you pick up a first down.
Right.
But only long enough for the chains to set here. So you likely got to run something to the edges and try to get out of bounds.
Got to go to Downs, down and out. Get out of bounds.
Urzua cranks it up, goes deep for Cunningham, and Cunningham, an incredible one-handed catch, going out of bounds with 8 seconds left in the half.
Unbelievable. What a great play. Good coverage by McEachern, but watch this catch. Wow.
Spectacular one-handed catch by Giovanni Cunningham. Stepping out of bounds. They're going to try to run a play for the end zone right here with 8 seconds left, and they're set up to do it. Let's see where they've spotted it out. I believe the 7-yard line. They got to be careful here. You don't want to lose an opportunity to get 3 points. Urzua, quick fire to the end zone. Jump ball, Downs makes the grab for the touchdown. Downs with the touchdown catch with 3 seconds to play in the half.
Plenty of time, Matt.
How do you like that?
Wow, I like that. That's great clock management. Good throwing by Urzua. He was on target both passes there.
What an incredible turn of events here as North Gwinnett has taken a 13-7 lead before halftime.
And they were on the ropes just moments ago.
After the 39-yard run by Paris Brown, McEachern had it at the 19-yard line. First down through the interception. The PAT by Clark is good. And with 3 seconds to play in the half, North Gwinnett has stunned McEachern to take a 14-7 lead.
Excellent throw by Urzua to Downs in the end zone. Unbelievable 2 minutes of play here.
Your TCSG touchdown replay. And look at Downs follow that thing all the way into his arms. He just nestled underneath. A perfect pass from Urzua. Just a little rainbow shot over the defense. Fell right into the arms of Downs for the touchdown. And that was a great catch, following a great catch by Giovanni Cunningham, a one-handed grab, stepping out of bounds at the 7-yard line to set up that touchdown.
They were on the ropes after the Brown run, yeah. No doubt. Boy, that's bouncing back, isn't it?
Well, that's what Bill Stewart was telling us about this week. This team's been able to bounce back and fight back from adversity, and they had created a lot of adversity for themselves in this ball game with the turnovers. Looks like they were about to go down 14-7 before halftime. Instead, they go up 14-7 before halftime.
And the quarterback option portion of the sprint option is open all night long.
Now, here is where you definitely pooch kick. Line drive kick. And that is the end of the half on the short return by McCoy Morris. And North Gwinnett leads McEachern 14-7 here at halftime as we check in with Sam Crenshaw.
Coach Stewart, halftime score 14-7. An emotional roller coaster for you. Describe this first half.
We're fortunate to be here on that. The turnovers killed us, two in a row right there, and then a third one going in the score. But our kids kept playing and stuff, so we just got to keep our composure and keep executing. And so we finally got into a rhythm a little bit at the end there.
What did you think about that interception? What did you think when you saw the interception on that end?
That was critical, man. That was a big play at that moment, and I think that was Clinton over there, and it was just a great play, and they just ripped us, and so it's just blowing up and getting it done, and we got a long half to go.
Let's see more football in the second half. Good luck to you.
It's a fun game, yep. Let's go, yep.
All right, let's Coach Stewart. 14-7, our halftime score. Let's go over Nicky and John.
What he said, it's been a fun first half of football. I think 5 turnovers, tremendous catches on both sides of the ball. We got scores, we got stuff, we got bands. What else is going on?
We got social, we've got score updates, schedules. It's all coming at you on our halftime show.
Backroads and Backfields also takes a look at Heard County. The end around gets them set up for a tremendous catch in the end zone. Just when you thought momentum was going to be McEachern's, it's North Gwinnett heading to the break. Halftime show coming up on the great GPB.
Canucci EMC is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
If you text while driving, it's like turning the wheel over to your dear old grandpa, your nosy neighbor, your nephew. No, the younger one. And on top of everything else, it's against the law. Heads up, Georgia. Texting and driving is deadly on our roads. Put down the phone. Drive alert. Arrive alive.
For many teens, the freedom of driving can come at a terrible price, as vehicle crashes remain the leading cause of death for teens in America. The Ford Motor Company Fund is dedicated to ending these tragedies. Our Ford Driving Skills for Life Academy is a free online driving program for teen drivers featuring advanced skills from professional instructors.
For more information, go to drivingskillsforlife.com. As a proud sponsor of the Georgia High School Football Playoffs on GPB, stay safe and enjoy the games.
Regions Bank is always looking for opportunities to help communities and individuals move forward. In addition to offering financial solutions to our customers, we're committed to supporting local initiatives and organizations that help our neighborhoods thrive. Regions is proud to partner with Georgia Public Broadcasting in building a better Georgia.
This program on GPB is made possible in part by supporters of the Georgia High School Association, including the following.
Support for GPB comes from Georgia Farm Bureau Mutual Insurance. From front porches to back roads, down the street or around the block, Georgia Farm Bureau is there with the protection families need, whether it's home, auto or life insurance, or something more. Georgia Farm Bureau is dedicated to providing the right coverage to all the friends, families, and neighbors who make this state home. More at gfbinsurance.com. Georgia Farm Bureau, always the home team.
Welcome back. Welcome back. Halftime, the McEachern Band on the field. We'll be catching up with them in just a sec. Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium. Halfway home to figure out who's going to be bound for the bins in one half of the bracket in 7A. We'll have scores and let you know who else is headed to the bins in just a bit. But let's send it over to Nikki and the big board. What's going on in social media?
Well, the fans have been going crazy in the stands, and they've been going crazy online too. But you know, GBB country is huge, and I just want to find out how big we are. Sometimes we find out we're as big as Scotland. So where are you watching from tonight? Let us know. Send us a picture, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat. We want to know, how far away are you? If you are the fan watching from farthest away, we're going to hook you up with some GPB swag, just like our friends over here in the stands. They've got some GPB swag. You know why? Because they've got swag. They are excited about the game. They're excited about the holidays. Look at this adorable Santa Clausette with her equally adorable GPB Sports water bottle. Be like the cute Santa Clausette. Get out there. Get excited. We're looking for you guys. Send us your photos on social media. And look at this. They are just nuts about the holidays in North Gwinnett. McEachern, where you at? We're on the prowl for some McEachern fans. So, guys, stand by. In the meantime, make sure you are following us, GPB Sports. Download that app. Find us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat. It's like we're in your home. We're everywhere you go. John?
We are everywhere you go. All right. That's the first round of the big board here at halftime. Let's send it out onto the half and out onto the field with the McEachern High School Marching Band, brought to us, as always, by our friends at Regions Bank.
Welcome back, guys. We've got more coming up on the halftime show, so make sure you stick with us. We are going to check in with the North Gwinnett Bulldogs Marching Band, see what's going on out there in the land of social, and get you guys some score updates. So what do you say, John? Stick and stay?
Stick and stay. We'll be back in just a little bit. We got Backroads and Backfields also around the corner. A visit to the town of Franklin. North Gwinnett up 14-7 at the half. Stick and stay. We'll be back in just a sec. Promise.
We are the TV Doctors of America, and we may not know much about medicine, but we know a lot about drama.
From scandalous romance
to ridiculous plot twists.
Son?
Dad.
We also know you can avoid drama by getting an annual checkup.
So we're partnering with Cigna to remind you to go see a real doctor.
Go, know, and take control of your health.
It could save your life. Doctor poses.
Dad.
Cigna, together all the way.
Learning a trade could be the best investment in your career. As leading industries search for talent, those with skilled trade education and technical training often stand out above the competition. From logistics, construction and manufacturing to telecommunications and energy, the possibilities are endless for tradesmen and women. You can build the future you want with your own two hands, and Trade 5 is here to help. Trade 5, skills for higher earning.
Komatsu Forklift of Atlanta. Since 1962, Komatsu Forklift of Atlanta has had a heritage of providing quality material handling solutions to companies of all sizes throughout the state of Georgia. With over 50 years of experience, Komatsu Forklift of Atlanta provides budget-minded solutions in new, used, rental, and parts and service to keep your business running smoothly. Komatsu Forklift of Atlanta, our commitment is built to keep you working longer.
When I was 16, I knew I wanted to be a welder. When I was in high school, I took a welding course at my technical college. I was 17 when I received my first full-time paycheck. In less than 2 years, I earned my technical diploma.
Dual enrollment at Georgia's 22 technical colleges. Double the credit, half the time, zero the tuition. Learn more at doublethecredit.org.
Whether behind the scenes, behind the camera, or running the show, our volunteers bring GPB to life. To get involved, visit gpb.org/volunteer.
Carol EMC is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
Welcome back to Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium. We are at intermission. North Gwinnett, the home team, leading McEachern 2-1, otherwise known as 14-7 in football terms. Big momentum switch there at the end when you thought McEachern was going to score second quarter. Turnover on the interception. Big return coming back the other way.
Cunningham. You know, I feel, John, like we've seen three different games in one half.
I think so. Yeah, what, five turnovers total. A lot of momentum shifts either way. McEachern short fields getting it into the end zone, and they were tied at 7-7. Big catch at the end of the half made it 14-7. Matt and Tommy will have the second half in just a little bit. But let's take a peek at what else is going on around the state. That one at the break. Big goal line stand for Brookwood in the other half of the 7A bracket, leading Colquitt County. That one's heading toward the third quarter. Coffee and Tucker, that one's now in the third. Trojans leading that one 7-3. Glen Academy, we can update that one. That one's now 31-14, early third quarter. Rome leading Buford. Battle of Wolves at Barron Stadium. You cannot get a seat for that one. 17-7, Rome at the half. Knox Kadem, two touchdown passes there. Second quarter, Warner Robins leading Carver Atlanta by the score of 14-7. Scoreboard brought to us by our friends at Georgia's EMCs. Marist scores late in the first half. They lead St. Pius 13-7. Blessed Trinity up 14-0 at one point. They now lead only 14-7. And Forsyth, Peach County, safety at the end of the second quarter. They lead 12-7 at GAC. Calhoun leading Cedar Grove at Godfrey Stadium 7-0. And that one is not a typo. Raven leading Brooks by the score of 7-5 at the break up in Tiger. At the break, big goal line stand for Hayteville Charter. Tied with Heard County at 14. Clinch County got a safety late in single A. They are now at 16-14 at the break. ECI now up 29-14. Thanks to Steve Carter for the update on that one. Eric Dixon, a touchdown run from 46 yards out. Eagles Landing Christian is rolling. And Mount Perrin and Athens Academy are tied at 7-7 as they head toward the third quarter. Once again, scoreboard brought to us by our friends at Georgia's EMCs. So where do we go from here?
Oh, you know where we go from here.
Where do we go from
next
here?
Next weekend, it is everything we have all been waiting for. It is the state championships, and I hope you guys are going to be well-rested and ready for this. We are starting things really early Friday, December 8th. Bring me some breakfast. Class A private, kicking everything off, followed up by 3A and then 5A at 4:30. And we wrap it up with Class 6A at 8 p.m. We get up early again on December 9th. This time we start things off
bring
with Class
again.
A public. Bring me donuts. 2A at 1 o'clock, 4A, 4:30. And we put a bow on all of it at 8 o'clock, Class 7A. How about it? I'm excited. I'm going to be rested. You guys are too. And you know what? If you have that GPB Sports app, we can go with you everywhere, and you guys don't have to miss a second. Now, let's listen into the North Gwinnett Bulldogs marching band brought to you by our friends at Regions Bank. Now let's buckle our seatbelts and head over to Heard County with John for some back roads and backfields.
Heard County is officially a new territory for 2017, a first ever semifinal for a school that first played football in 1972 and had to wait until 1973 to win their first game. A lot of the attention has gone to the nation's number three dual threat quarterback in Emory Jones, rightfully so, and his game has changed as the Braves finally make it to a game 14.
I think my game has grown like, tremendously. I think more in the leadership part of it, in the mental part of the game. I've been studying a lot this past summer, this offseason. I've been going to a lot of camps, stuff like that, and just developing more, getting ready for this season.
It's not been difficult. You know, he was an early commit, and of course he's still getting a lot of, you know, a lot of people are still on him, calling him and those things, but he's well grounded. His mother's done a great job of making a good young man. He's been very humble, so it hasn't been a distraction from what we're trying to do.
About Heard County, the cities of Franklin, Central Hatchie, Ephesus, and Corinth added up to a population just north of 11,500 in the last census, and the Braves mean, well, let's just say they mean a lot to the county and county pride.
I mean, it's everything. We went 4 hours to Thomasville, and we had a large crowd, so it means a lot to them.
It's hard to explain, man. You come down to Staples Stadium on a Friday night, you're gonna get happy. You're gonna be excited because there's just so many people, and everybody knows everybody.
In Franklin, as you know, there's one red light, so it's not like that there's a whole lot to do on a Friday night. So they take a lot of pride in supporting all the kids. It doesn't matter if it's football season, it's football. Basketball's basketball, baseball's baseball. You know, it doesn't matter what it is. The community gets behind whatever events we got going on at the school. And it doesn't have to be athletics. Just super supportive, great community. You know, if somebody had told me 16 years ago that I was going to be at Heard County, I'd have said no. But you get here and you fall in love with the place. You realize it's a great place to raise a family. It was good for our family, and we've been blessed just to be a part of it.
Back roads and backfields, and guess what got added to the hat stack on my desk? Thanks to Tim Barron and everybody in Franklin for adding Heard County to the stacks of the lids, which I think there's now over 450 of them in the collection, and it is still growing. Once again, tied at 14, Heard County and Hapeville Charter, both teams in their first semifinal. And the winner of that one heads to the bins. Let's send it back over to Nikki in the big board.
Who never gets any hats. I just want to point that out, guys. If you got some extra hats that you want to give me, I would like to have a hat. And you know what? There are some fans that are getting some GPB swag in the stands. You guys know we were giving North Gwinnett their time in our last hit. And McEachern said, I don't think so. They're back with their school spirit, getting hooked up in the stands. Bound for the bins. Check out these lovely ladies with their fidget spinners. I have one in my pocket, and I'm going to tell you what right now. The rowdiest fan is going to get this fidget spinner, and you're going to need it to get through this game. If it looks anything like the first half, you could use yourself a fidget spinner. Guys, find us all over the internet at GPB Sports. If you're awesome, we're going to show you right here on our show. John, are you going to give me that hat, or am I going to have to beg?
There's no begging involved. You're not going to get this particular hat because it's going on my stacks. But maybe we can talk about something. I've got Tim Barron's cell number. Maybe he can help you out. That is it for halftime. When we come back, we'll take a peek at the third quarter and the second half. Winner of this game goes to the Bens. Hashtag bound for the Bens. North Gwinnett leading McEachern by the score of 14-7. Sam Crenshaw will catch up with Kyle Hockman on the flip side of the break. And Tommy Palmer, Matt Stewart, will take you the rest of the way in regulation. There, I used that word. We come back second half from Suwannee when we return on the great GPB. Stick and stay.
I've always wanted to be a nurse. I'm getting the clinical training I need with credits that may transfer, and my tuition is free.
There are a lot of programs in Georgia's technical colleges to choose from. And I found the one that was right for me. At the place that really cares for and supports me.
The Technical College System of Georgia. Meaningful careers start here.
Central Georgia EMC is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
Regions Bank is always looking for opportunities to help communities and individuals move forward. In addition to offering financial solutions to our customers, we're committed to supporting local initiatives and organizations that help our neighborhoods thrive. Regions is proud to partner with Georgia Public Broadcasting in building a better Georgia.
Across 91 counties, Georgia's cotton industry employs over 15,000 people, with more than 3,000 Georgia farmers that bring cotton into our everyday lives. When life turns up the heat and the pressure makes you sweat, there's one sure way to cool down. For those glory moments on and off the court, cotton is with you for the win. Cotton, the natural choice for Georgia.
Join the conversation on GPB Radio every day from 5 a.m. to 7 p.m. on 88.5 FM in Atlanta. Or tune in to one of our network of stations across the state. GPB News, empowering you one story at a time.
And welcome back to Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium. We are just about done with halftime right here with North Gwinnett leading McEachern 14-7 as the Bulldogs come back out on the field after a stunning rally at the end of the second quarter when it appeared they were about to go down 14-7. They flipped the script, turned the tables on McEachern to claim a 14-7 lead on a touchdown pass from Jimmy Urzua with just 3 seconds left on the clock. Now let's take a look at the highlights, Tommy, from what happened there in the first half. Mistakes and fumbles killed the Bulldogs early.
You know, we really thought the momentum had gotten away from them, as a matter of fact, due to those turnovers, because McEachern breaks on top early. Then here comes North Gwinnett coming back. Spread option. And now a pass. A great reception. And here's the touchdown to Downs right before the half. I thought they were doing a great job of managing the clock there, Matt.
Indeed, they did a super job. And Giovanni Cunningham, of course, had two spectacular plays on a reverse and a one-handed catch in that first half. And the interception by DJ Turner as well by the Bulldogs, one of the most spectacular interceptions you'll see this entire season. Halftime stats, you can see that North Gwinnett with 190 to McEachern's 140. Only 4 first downs for McEachern in that first half and 5 total turnovers. I think the big question, Tommy, as we head to the second half is who can hold on to the football. That might be the team that wins.
I think that could be it, because you take a look at North Gwinnett, they've got 190 total yards, 9 first downs, but they've got 3 turnovers. And you take a look at McEachern, they've got 8 penalties for 52 yards. North Gwinnett, 1 penalty. So it's been a lot of this for one team and a lot of this. Third down conversions are very disappointing for both. 2 out of 5 for North Gwinnett, and McEachern, 1 out of 7.
24 minutes, bound for the bins. One of these teams, North Gwinnett, trying to get there for a third time. McEachern trying to get there for the first time since 1998. Third quarter starts in a moment.
Every morning, ag dogs wake up ready to attack the challenges ahead of them. We take pride in our work because what we do improves people's lives. From advancing food security to sustaining the health of our earth. Whether solving problems in the field or making new discoveries in the lab, we're always innovating. We know that our future relies on our work. To an ag dog, progress is more than just a concept. It's our commitment.
We are the TV Doctors of America, and we may not know much about medicine,
but we know a lot about drama.
From scandalous romance
to ridiculous plot twists.
Son?
Dad.
We also know you can avoid drama by getting an annual checkup.
So we're partnering with Cigna to remind you to go see a real doctor.
Go, know, and take control of your health.
It could save your life.
Doctor poses.
Dad.
Cigna, together all the way.
Coastal Electric is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
14-7, a halftime score. North Gwinnett leads McEachern. McEachern head coach Kyle Hockman out of the locker room now. Thoughts about what you shared with your team during the break?
Just doing fundamental things better. We had a lot of opportunities early
and we didn't cash in. We cashed in on one, but had two or three others. And then as they kind of settled down, and they made plays, we didn't in the second quarter. Very simple. We had the opportunities, didn't make them. They did, and we are where we are. Now we just settle down and get back just playing football, eye discipline, doing basic fundamental things, simple things. And I think we've been in tough situations before, so let's go see what it's all about.
We'll see what it's all about. Good luck in the second half.
Amen.
That is Coach Hopkins. Back upstairs now, Matt Dowie.
All right, thank you, Sammy McEachern. The theme this week was bust down the door. That's kind of been where they have been. This is their third trip to the semifinals in the last 5 years. They've had difficulty getting beyond this semifinal round in 2013. North Gwinnett beat them in the semifinals before the Bulldogs lost to Norcross in the state championship game. And busting down the door is something that McEachern's trying to do. McEachern is, it's kind of an Atlanta Braves kind of distinction, if you will, and I don't mean that in a bad way, but they have more, they're the program with the most region championships without a state championship.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Then they've been to one state title game. That was in 1998, and it was totally unexpected that they would even be in the semifinals this year. But now that they are there, Kyle Hochman wants this team to finally break through and overcome the fear and anxiety, knock down the barrier, get to the next game. Down to John Nelson.
Bonus coverage, guys. Let's take you to Barron Stadium in Rome. Wolves versus Wolves. And guess what happens here? Buford goes three and out. Knox Kadem picks it up, and he's going to go from one end of the screen to the other. 51 yards into the end zone. 2 minutes gone, third quarter. Rome is rolling up 24-7
wow.
in their matchup against Buford. Lee County has scored. That one is now 31-21, third quarter in Leesburg. Glenn Academy is winning that one. Big night for Kane Cruz. He already has a hat trick on the ground in single A, updating a shootout in Osceola. ECI now lead Irwin County 29-22. Irwin has scored on fourth down, and they are only 3 minutes into the third quarter. Raven County still hanging on, this close to getting a title, winning 10-5 over Brooks County in Tiger. Third quarter back upstairs.
Jimmy Urzua, what a season this senior has had. Began the year as a backup to Cade Fortin, the starting quarterback who's committed to Texas A&M. Cade Fortin broke his leg in game number two and was lost for the season. It has been Jimmy Urzua's team this entire year through a touchdown pass with 3 seconds left in the half to put his team up 14-7 as we start the second quarter. And as Bill Stewart said, you know, in this day and age, a lot of kids in his spot get to their senior year. You could be starting someplace else.
Yeah.
Just transfer to another school where you get a chance to play. But Jimmy Urzua stuck it out, and the opportunity came at the unfortune of Cade Fortin, but he stuck it out with North Gwinnett, and here he has a chance to get the Bulldogs into the state championship game.
Yep. Both of these football teams have had ample opportunity in the first half to take control. It'll be interesting to see which one takes control here in the second half, Matt.
Winner of this ball game will play either Colquitt County or Brookwood in the 7A state championship game next Saturday night. Colquitt County has taken a 24-14 lead on Brookwood in the third quarter. The short kick is going to be taken at the 20-yard line. Heads up, Georgia.com bringing you our second half kickoff. And the 32-yard line is where the Bulldogs will put the ball in play for the first time here in the third quarter. And for the first time, they go on offense with the lead.
I hope prosperity doesn't get the best of them here. They're up 14-7 in good position. Receive the second half kickoff. And they've got Mr. Goodson in the backfield.
Goodson with 11 carries for 40 yards in that first half. Urzua 6 of 8 for 71 yards and a touchdown. And most of that came on the final drive. They go to the air. Great catch! Plucked out of the air by Riley Walker. That was the first catch for him tonight. Gets it across the 50 to the 47-yard line. That's a 20-yard pickup for Riley Walker.
This is another play that's been open all night. The slant. Somebody just finally caught it. This is only the second time they've completed the slant. It's been open all night long.
First and 10. Toss goes to Goodson. Comes to the short side. And Goodson lowers his shoulder and out of bounds at the 43-yard line. He picks up 5 on the play.
for North Gwinnett to be successful, they've got to get a good dose of Goodson and a good dose of Downs on the outside there, the wide receiver.
And Jovani Cunningham. Jovani Cunningham, to me, has been the star of the game for North Gwinnett. A huge 46-yard pickup on a reverse and a late catch inside the 10-yard line that set up their touchdown with 3 seconds to go.
Yeah.
Nothing doing right there for Goodson that time. Dante Fleming, the Mike linebacker, was the first guy there.
A little too much dance to go up in there. You can't do that with McEachern. Boy, those guys in that front four up there, they've gone to work here in the second half. I would imagine they got talked to at halftime.
Third down and 5 with the ball at the 43. Line to gain is the 38. Urzua throws it out there, and it's caught by Maynard. He's close to the sticks. Let's see where they spot it. I think he picked up the first down. He did. He ran a yard beyond the sticks, and Garrison Maynard with the first down catch. I like the way this North Gwinnett offense is starting to look here.
Yeah.
Really starting to come on.
They've scripted it at halftime, I'm sure of that.
Keeper Urzua tosses back to Downs. Downs got a block out there on the edge, and Josh Downs runs out of bounds at the 30-yard line as he picks up 6 on the play.
This is a really good offensive North Gwinnett football team. A lot of people don't know that, but they are a really high-powered offense.
And how about the quick pass when it looked like Urzua was going to cross the line of scrimmage and run with it?
A lot of athleticism on that red and white football team down there.
Second down, handoff, and nothing doing for Crosby that time. Fairbanks was there again.
Wow.
Devin Hart was there. Ishmael Bridges.
I don't know that anybody has blocked Fairbanks all night long and really handled him one-on-one.
He's had a great game.
He has.
Good-looking 6'3", 260 senior committed to UAB. Chose the Blazers over Marshall. Southern Miss, close to 20 offers. Third down. You know, he played hurt most of last year. He had shoulder surgery in January. Urzua, quick pass in the middle on the slant, complete to Fisher. Fisher inside the 15, cuts back. His knee didn't hit the ground. That's a touchdown. That 32 yards, Fisher cut, put his hand in the ground to keep his knee off the ground and scored the touchdown.
That play has been open all night long, as I told you, Matt. There it is again.
Watch this balance right here. Wow.
Whoa.
Man, we have had some highlight reel plays tonight.
We really have. These are some great football players. Such speed, Matt, just in the open field.
Great play by Fisher. DJ Turner had an interception that you wouldn't believe. Jovani Cunningham had a one-handed catch that you wouldn't believe.
And Urzua has really warmed up and is on target.
Clark with the PAT. It's 21-7. What a turn of events.
Watch this throw, Matt.
Your TCSG touchdown replay.
That was a dart. Thank goodness for gloves. Quit stick them on them. That was a gunslinger throw there. Great throw by Urzua. Great catch. Great run.
Urzua was 4 for 4, 65 yards, and you can see the prolific nature of their offense. 50-plus in 2 of their 3 playoff games. They put 35 on Grayson. And at no point the entire season did they score less than 4 touchdowns in a game, and that was in their loss to Walton. They scored 4 touchdowns in their season opener.
I think the Bulldogs are warming up, Matt. What do you think?
Well, it's been a stunning turn of events because, like I said, it appeared they were about to go down a touchdown. Short kick at the 30-yard line and stopped at the 37. They were about to go down a touchdown and be down 14-7 after Paris Brown broke off a 39-yard run to the 14-yard line. They took a 5-yard penalty. They were facing first and 15 at their 19 when Carlos Del Rio Wilson threw a pick that went back 51 yards the other way. With 1 minute left, they went 50 yards for the touchdown.
Amazing. Amazing.
And they come out and start the third quarter with a touchdown drive of 68 yards on 7 plays.
Right.
And now they're up 2 scores. And let's see where they go here. They go Malik Evans. And I think they have to. I think the freshman, Carlos Del Rio Wilson, just has not been effective tonight. And I think you got to go with Malik Evans here, the senior, and see if he can bring you back.
Yeah.
They go to the air with him. That's thrown complete. Brandon Christie with the catch. That's just the third completion for the Indians tonight.
Yeah, they have not really thrown it much. They've just kind of ridden Paris Brown, and that's been about it. They've had him at the Wildcat and several different places, and it makes you wonder, you know, what are they going to do offensively here?
Well, they were 2 for 9 for 19 yards and an interception in that first half. So when they did throw it, they were not effective. Handoff goes to Paris Brown, and Jaden McDonald gets him on the ground. Let's go down to John Nelson.
Updating your bonus coverage from Barron Stadium in Rome. It's going to go a couple of different ways and end up in the hands of Jamias Griffin. Watch the dive at the end into the end zone. 15 yards on the reverse. 31-7.
Wow.
Rome leading Buford. 2 minutes to go, third quarter.
Wow.
Here it's third down and 8 with the ball at the 39. McEachern desperately needs to move the sticks here. Heavy rush. Puccarello chasing Malik Evans. He's going to pick up the first down and more. Evans down the sideline and still on his feet and across the 30 down to the 26. And that's what Malik Evans can do for you.
That's how you get back into the football game. Malik Evans got blocking, had good protection, got flushed out of there. They ran a stunt, but boy, he got great blocking downfield. This guy is quick as a hiccup.
Well, I think you just saw how McEachern, as you pointed out, gets back in this ball game. You spread the field and let Malik Evans run the ball.
Do what he does.
Handoff goes Paris Brown. Big hole for him. Jaden McDonald rises back to the ground at the 20-yard line.
Even if you're not a North Gwinnett fan, you got to like the way McDonald plays the football game.
He's had a huge game.
He has had a game.
Brings up a second down and 5. I'd like to see that kid get some offers.
He's skinny,
6'2", 10.
He's worthy.
But I think you can put some muscle on that frame right there. Keeper by Evans inside the 15 and down to the 10-yard line. Malik Evans carrying this Indians team on his back. A couple of big runs right there. And now the Indians are facing a first and goal to go, or it might be a first and 10 just outside the 10. It is just outside the 10 at about the 11.
For most people who don't remember, this is the same McEachern football team that was down 21 points to Lowndes with 4.5 minutes to go in the football game. They won the game at Lowndes.
49 yards for Evans on this drive with his legs. Hand off Jalen Thornton, and there's Jaden McDonald
again. Look at there.
Someone give that kid an offer.
I'm telling you. He can play on our team anytime, can't he, Matt? Can't he, Matt?
He got great pursuit. Great tackler, too. Big night for Jaden McDonald.
Yeah.
Second down and 10.5 from just outside the 11. Yard to gain is the 1. Let's see if Evans takes off running again. Nope, going to hand off to Paris Brown. Paris Brown slams his body inside that 5-yard line. Payne Walker making the stop for the Bulldogs, and now it's going to be third down.
Just zone blocking up front, step left, and then the back cuts generally where the center was. But that's all it is just zone blocking, left and right. Not a lot of pulling the guards or cross blocking or anything like that. It's just zone blocking up front. And boy, do they have a line of scrimmage up front.
Third down. Ball at the 9. Keeper Evans going to fire out on the flats to the tight end, Austin Jones. He gets knocked out of bounds at the five-yard line, and now it's fourth down.
You got to take the points here, I think, Matt. It's too much time left in this ball game. You're 6:08. You're halfway through the third quarter. You're not in danger. You got to take points here, I think.
I think they're going for it. I don't know that they trust their kicking game enough that they believe these would be automatic points right here. Fourth down, yard to gain, line to gain, pardon me, is the one. The ball's at the six or thereabouts. Evans looks to the sideline to get the play call from Hockman. Play clock is down to six. Fourth down, they're going for it. They're trying to draw them off sides. They're not going to be able to. They'll take a penalty. And now they will bring Ruben Rodriguez on to try to get the three.
Yeah.
Offense. Draw a penalty.
They need the points here. North Gwinnett has stunned them with two straight touchdowns here, I think. One at the end of the half and one to open the second half.
So Ruben Rodriguez, after the five-yard mark off, will attempt what will be a 28-yard attempt from the right hash.
Not a good angle down there, Matt.
Nope, going to have to angle it in there. He's a left-footed kicker, though.
That helps.
It does. He's got a good angle on it. High snap. They get it down. He puts it through. Nice kick by Ruben Rodriguez right through the uprights. The junior kicker does his job and cuts the North Gwinnett lead to 21-10.
And those points may come back and be important, Matt.
So 6 minutes to play in the third quarter. McEachern gets on the board. Both teams have scored on their opening possessions of this second half. It's an 11-point game.
Coweta Fayette EMC is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
If you text while driving, it's like turning the wheel over to your dear old grandpa, your nosy neighbor, your nephew. No, the younger one. And on top of everything else, it's against the law. Heads up, Georgia. Texting and driving is deadly on our roads. Put down the phone. Drive alert. Arrive alive.
For nearly 20 years, Georgia's electric membership cooperatives have made Friday night football electrifying. As the official energy provider of the GHSA, Georgia's EMCs are proud to support high school athletics in the communities we serve. Standing behind every hike, every completed pass, and every team celebration. Because we know that today's high school athletes are tomorrow's local leaders. Georgia's EMCs, official energy provider of the GHSA.
6 minutes, 2 seconds to play here in the third quarter. The 7A semifinals, North Gwinnett trying to reach the state championship game for the third time in their school history, the third time since 2007. McEachern trying to reach the state championship game for the second time in school history and the first since 1998. Winner gets Colquitt County or Brookwood Saturday night in Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Kickoff hits on the ground and is going to be picked up at the 27-yard line, breaking to the outside. It nearly backfired on them as the ball was picked up by Taylor Goodson. And Taylor Goodson runs up close to the 50-yard line.
Taylor Goodson was off for the races. One more step and he's gone for a touchdown.
I just don't like those pooch kicks.
I don't either. I don't want to see a kick.
I don't understand. I don't understand the rationale when you're giving the team the ball at the 50-yard line
that's
or thereabouts.
That's cutting the field in half.
But both teams have been doing it all night long.
Yeah, they have.
So the ball's at the 47-yard line. Handoff.
Goodson.
Goodson on the run. Devin Hart on the tackle after a 2-yard gain. Tyler Goodson. A couple of yards on that play. Second down and 8.
They've got to get Goodson saddled up again.
47 yards on 13 tough carries for Goodson. Goodson on that near edge picks up the first down. Look at him lower his shoulder. Wow. Running with authority right there, plowing into Irwin Bird, the corner. That's an 11-yard pickup.
That's not exactly a small secondary he's running through back there either. Some big defensive backs. Ow. That one will smart a little tomorrow.
First and 10 from the 40. That's Devin Crosby on the carry that time. He gets slammed to the ground. Devin Hart, Dante Fleming meet him at the line of scrimmage.
I'll tell you what, big 58 was in there somewhere too. I'll tell you what, my advice would be don't even run that way.
Look at Michael Fairbanks. His jersey's all ripped. Just tear it off. I don't need that.
I don't either. Look, it's hung on his glove. Throw it off there, big guy.
That's a defensive end right there.
You got that right.
He's going to go to the sideline and eat a bucket of nails. Second down and 10. Urzua fires. Incomplete. Might have been some contact. Maynard was the target, and there goes the flag. I think Folks was on his back.
The reason that's called is because Urzua has been so true on every one of his throws. He has been on the money. That was a catchable ball.
Pass interference on the defense. 15-yard penalty.
Take a look at the throw. Urzua throws darts out there, folks. He's not lobbing it. He's humming it.
His brother John is at Middle Tennessee, was a starting quarterback here when Bob Spire was the head coach. First and 10 for the Bulldogs. Handoff goes to Goodson. Goodson, Fairbanks, bear hugs him again. That was Jamil Burrows that time who made the tackle at the 14-yard line, and a pickup of about six on the play for Tyler Goodson.
Nothing fancy up front on either side. Just man on man, a little pushing and shoving. Who's the strongest? Who can move who?
10 penalties, 72 yards now for McEachern. Goodson runs into his own man and then runs to the end zone. Touchdown.
I think we're going to have holding here.
A 19-yard touchdown run, but Fisher, L.J. Fisher downfield, who had the 32-yard touchdown catch earlier in this quarter, might have been holding. But North Gwinnett seems to believe it's going to go against McEachern.
Yeah, they're pointing to McEachern, and Coach Stewart's pointing to McEachern.
Waiting to get the call
holding
here.
On the offense.
It is going to be holding.
10 yards.
That will erase the
results
touchdown for North Gwinnett.
Yeah. He really didn't need to be blocking. He needed to turn to loose here. Turn loose.
Yeah.
Let him go.
That's L.J. Fisher down there, and you can see he was clearly holding his jersey.
Yeah.
And Dwayne White turned around and said to the officials, "Do you see that?" Yeah, they saw it. Urzua spin move.
Oh, my.
And he's going to go down at the 9-yard line. His spin move's not quite as quick as Tyler Goodson's spin move.
Not quite. But it's a good effort.
Second down, line to gain is about the 1.5. Goodson goes in motion. Urzua looks his way. Goes to the end zone for Downs instead and overthrows him this time. Downs was able to slip out behind the defense and Jeremiah Folks the corner. And it's going to be third down.
Great pattern that time by Downs, but Urzua just overthrew him. He had him out there.
Josh Downs made the 7-yard touchdown catch with 3 seconds left in the first half that put North Gwinnett on top at the time, 14-7. And they have led ever since. Now threatening to go up by 18 points here if they can punch it in. But it's third down. Time for Urzua. Floats it up there, and Fisher can't run under it. Dwayne White on the coverage, and now it's going to be fourth down. Let's see if they bring Cameron Clark out for a field goal attempt.
I'm not sure. Urzua is looking like, well, now he's saying, oh, my fault.
So Cameron Clark will come on as they try to match the field goal by Ruben Rodriguez here. This will be right in the middle of the field, and this one will be about a 27-yarder. Rodriguez hit a 28-yarder just a few moments ago. See Clark, 50% on his field goal attempts this season. Kick is on its way, and the kick is good.
Yeah. High snap, got it down in time, and the kick is good.
27-yard field goal by Cameron Clark. And it's now 24-10 as you take a look at the Bulldogs' program resume. 9 10-win seasons in the last 12 years. None in the previous 44. State finalist in 2013 and also in 2007 for the first time. 6 region titles the last 9 years. They were region champions again this year. 2 playoff appearances from 1961 to 2001. But that's before Bob Spire arrived on the scene, and he turned this program into a state championship contender. His 11 seasons here in Suwannee, 110 wins and just 28 losses, 2 state finals appearances.
Yeah, he's quite a coach, quite a coach. And of course, Coach Stewart has taken over this year. He's really done a great job with this football team. A lot of adversity on this football team as far as injuries are concerned, Matt.
Well, Bill Stewart came from Florida, where he was the head coach at his alma mater, Armwood High School in Tampa. He came to Georgia and was on Cecil Flo's staff on some of those state championship teams as the defensive coordinator at Parkview, became the head coach at Etowah, had 6 great years at Etowah. Again, a bouncy kick that's going to be fielded by Hull, and Hull slips back trying to make a cut, goes down at the 34 as we check back in with John Nelson.
Fourth quarter update from Barron Stadium in Rome. Bonus coverage that we're showing you tonight. And it's Knox Kadem again from the 32. Fakes the handoff and wide open. No one touches him. 8-18 in counting regulation. It's the most points that Buford has given up since the 2004 state title game. 38-7,
wow.
Rome over Buford.
I was getting ready to say, Nelly, that they probably had some seasons over the last decade where they didn't give up 38 points in the
See,
season.
Now you're having me do math all over again.
Pass is thrown complete to Hull, and he gets wrestled to the ground after a short 2-yard gain.
Neither of these teams are going to bend to us on this kicking thing, are they, Matt?
No, they're not.
Pooch and roll kicks all night long.
Carlos Del Rio Wilson back in there at quarterback. After Malik Evans had led them to the field goal, and now they bring Carlos Del Rio Wilson out, and they will go Wildcat here with Paris Brown. I mean, that's interesting because Paris Brown in there, that tells you you're not going to pass it unless you're going to. Well, that handoff to Jalen Thornton right there. I guess you could put Malik Evans in there and hand it off to him and let him pass. I mean, I don't know that Paris Brown's going to throw the ball any. Isaiah Lee we have not seen tonight. I know he was a little bit injured. I don't know whether he was even available tonight. When we talked to the coach earlier in the week, that was a question mark. But 3 different quarterbacks have played tonight for the Indians.
He's a sophomore, only 5'7", 160.
But he's had some moments for Indians this season as well.
All 3 of them have.
Malik Evans back in there at quarterback. Going to keep it on the read. Comes to the short side and picks up the first down, or close to it. He might not have picked up the first down. I think he might have stepped out of bounds shy of the sticks.
We're going to get a hold here. There was another undressing on the left-hand side. And it's going to be on McEachern, wide receiver.
Well, here's the decision for Bill Stewart to make. Do you take the penalty? Because if you don't, it's going to be 4th down and 2. Or do you back him up and make him play 3rd down again?
That penalty's declined.
They're going to decline, yeah.
Yeah. Need to stouten up here if you're declining penalties here on 4th and 2.
Well, let's see if McEachern's going to go for it here on 4th and 2 with under 3 minutes to play in the 3rd quarter. They're going to go for it.
Yeah.
I think Bill Stewart was thinking they would punt on 4th and 2 in their own end, and instead, they're going for it.
he may call timeout. Somebody called timeout.
Yeah, McEachern did.
Yeah.
I think they want to rethink this thing.
Yeah, I think both of them really want to rethink this thing.
I know you're down 14. I don't think you want to go for it on fourth and two right here. As you take a look at the Indians program resume, semifinalists in 2013 and 14, so this is their third semifinal appearance in 5 years. 17 region titles, and, of course, six of them coming under Kyle Hochman, the rest under the legendary Jimmy Dorsey, who's still the athletics director there at the Powder Springs School. They've won at least 10 games into the last 9 years, nine straight playoff appearances, and the aforementioned Jimmy Dorsey won 219 games with the Indians and took them to the 1998 state championship game.
A few wins in Powder Springs, right? McEachern, John McEachern High School, yes. Definitely.
So let's see what they do following the timeout here. A fourth down and two. I think it's too early to be going for it here on fourth and two because the failure is going to give North Gwinnett that short field. But it still looks like they're going for it.
Well, you got 14 and a half minutes left in the football game. It's a bit early to be gambling, I think.
It looks like that's what they're going to do here. Paris Brown lines up in the Wildcat. Will he quick kick it? Got two big old boys out there blocking in front of him. He's going to run it and pick up the first down. How about that? Gets more than that. 7-yard pickup for Paris Brown on a fourth down and two. Gutsy move right there. They put some big old hogs in there. Some guys in the backfield, some offensive linemen to block as blocking fullbacks, and they pick up the first down.
Let's call them the heavies.
There you go.
Put the heavies in there.
Some road graders is what they were. First and 10, ball at the 47. Del Rio Wilson back in there at quarterback, and a fire downfield, threw it short,
skipped.
Jerron Hall was his target. And a flag down. Their number one wide receiver, Genuine Potts, has been pretty much shut down tonight. They've only been able to connect with him once.
Erickson has been used on defense a lot. He's played a lot on both sides of the ball tonight. He's coming out and getting a breather now. Thank goodness he needs it.
Offense. 15-yard penalty.
Personal foul on McEachern.
First down replay.
Middle screen coming.
Yeah.
Right there. Yeah, you can't do that.
That's a no-no right there.
You can, but they will penalize you.
That's Alex Grant, the right guard, the young man who checks in at 377 that we were talking about earlier. Took out some frustrations on the Bulldog's helmet with a head inside of it.
That will make your ears ring, trust me.
12 penalties, 97 yards now for McEachern. Isaiah Lee now in there at quarterback, going to throw downfield, complete or incomplete to Hull, and a flag comes out. So Isaiah Lee, we were just talking about him a few moments ago. They lined him up in the slot and then brought him around on a handoff from Malik Evans to throw the ball downfield.
That's
and
great.
Let's check the flags.
That's great coverage down there by the North Gwinnett defense. I did not see a lot of pushing and shoving. Maybe it came prior to the throw, but I did not see it.
Pass interference. Defense. 15 yards.
I don't think Coach Stewart agrees with that call either, man.
So a 15-yard penalty, and it'll be first down for McEachern.
Let's check it. Here's Lee.
And that was actually Paris Brown who handed off to Isaiah Lee, who threw the ball downfield for Hull. So first and 10 for the Indians with the ball at the 47-yard line. Only the second penalty on the Bulldogs for 28 yards. Evans running option, and he's going to go down at the line of scrimmage. Not much doing right there. Ari Kamau making the tackle.
You don't expect him to be out there where that was. That's excellent motivation by one of the down linemen. He's actually the inside guard on that front four up there.
Second down. Del Rio Wilson going to take a sack, and that's Jaden McDonald, who's going to drop him for a big loss back inside the 35-yard line.
He is a player, no doubt. This kid can play.
They've had a hard time blocking Jaden McDonald tonight.
Yeah. Really haven't done much blocking of him tonight, to be honest with you, have they?
Hard to get a hat on him.
Yep.
And keep it there.
Now what have we got? And our flag fest continues.
Personal foul. Face mask. Defensive team. 15 yards.
So it looks like I'm guessing that Jaden McDonald might have been the offender there.
Let's check it and see. Here's the replay.
So we're told it's not Jaden McDowell, but it's number 30, Jake Stewart. I don't know.
He didn't touch him.
I think it was early on in the tackle when he kind of spun him around, might have grabbed a piece of that face mask at second down.
Maybe so. There's
pass
another.
Pass thrown out here to Hull. This is going to be a double pass downfield. Genuine Potts is open inside the 20, and Genuine Potts is going to score the touchdown.
And there's a flag at midfield.
Now, was that two forward passes? I think that's going to be the question mark here. A 46-yard touchdown if it stands.
I think it may be a forward pass this way and right. Then one this way.
Yeah, I think two
illegal
forward
formation.
Passes. No, illegal formation is the call.
5-yard penalty. Repeat. Second down.
Good call. Excellent execution. It was wide open, wasn't it, Matt?
So, yeah, it was definitely not a forward pass that way. Nicely executed, except for the illegal formation that wipes it off the board. And so now back to the 49 the ball goes with 54 seconds left here in the third quarter. Thornton in motion. Handoff goes. Direct snap to Paris Brown. He's dragging Jaden McDonald for the first down, or close to it. What a night for Paris Brown. He's up over 140 yards rushing.
He's had a good night. He's almost been on every play that McEachern's run offensively.
He's just a junior. 19 carries for 141. He's got offers already from South Carolina, Oregon, and Iowa State. I'm guessing that once tape of this game gets out, there'll be more.
I would think more, wouldn't you?
What a game here in the state semifinals for Paris Brown.
Yeah.
His uniform looks like he's been doing some work, too. Direct snap goes to Paris Brown. And Brown, look at him, bounce off a couple of tackles Earl Campbell and pick up the first down.
Just lower that shoulder and run past people and over people. Paris Brown is putting on a show. Let's give the man a break here.
Tide ain't going to help that jersey. I think they're just going to have to give him a new one. Down to 20 seconds to play in the half.
May have to burn that one.
Probably so, but if they get to play in the bins next Saturday, they'll be happy to do it.
Yeah.
First and 10. Evans goes to the air, short hops it to Genuine Potts. Stops the clock with 16 seconds to play in the third quarter.
Malik Evans has had a good night at times. He's really not played a whole lot. I mean, he's been in, out, in, out.
Yeah, I tell you, you got to commend this Indians offense with the switcheroos at the quarterbacks. They've had four different guys end up either taking snaps or throwing the ball tonight.
True.
Another flag out.
False start. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
And Coach Hockman's manner has not changed on the sideline. He is
serenity now, isn't he?
He is. He's a cool customer.
He really is, isn't he? He was that way in our conversation the other day, wasn't he, Matt?
He's always that way.
Yeah.
14 penalties now for McEachern. Second down. Time winding down here in the third quarter. Evans rolling to his left, throwing downfield. And is it caught? No, incomplete.
Wow.
Wow, we nearly had another spectacular grab as Brandon Christie got his hand on it but could not hold on to it when he hit the ground.
One-handed yet again. What is it with all these one-handed catches anymore? We're seeing them every week, Matt.
And Christie was getting an earful from DJ Turner as he was walking back upfield. Turner's probably saying, yeah, I caught it with one hand. You couldn't. It was close. It was close.
It
and
was.
And that was Newsom who was there to help break it up. 8 seconds to play in the quarter.
Yep.
Third down.
Evans is 4 for 53 rushing. 3 out of 4, 14 yards passing.
Heavy rush. Evans scrambling backwards, throws, and off the hands of his target at the 25-yard line. And his wide receiver, Genuine Potts, is on his back and shaken up as the third quarter comes to a close.
Wow.
I think the defender fell right on top of him as he was going for that football. And that is the end of the third quarter. You get a sense we're kind of sitting on a powder keg here as we head to the fourth quarter. Warren Erickson firing up his boys on the sideline. North Gwinnett down early in this ball game, a storm back to take a 24-10 lead to the fourth quarter. Bound for the bends with 12 minutes to go.
EMC is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
If you text while driving, it's like turning the wheel over to your dear old grandpa, your nosy neighbor, your nephew. No, the younger one. And on top of everything else, it's against the law. Heads up, Georgia. Texting and driving is deadly on our roads. Put down the phone. Drive alert. Arrive alive.
For nearly 20 years, Georgia's electric membership cooperatives have made Friday night football electrifying. As the official energy provider of the GHSA, Georgia's EMCs are proud to support high school athletics in the communities we serve, standing behind every hike, every completed pass, and every team celebration. Because we know that today's high school athletes are tomorrow's local leaders. Georgia's EMCs, official energy provider of the GHSA.
When I was in high school, I wasn't sure what career path to follow. I was introduced to the pharmacy tech program at a technical college, and I love it. I have taken college courses in retail and hospital pharmacy at absolutely no cost to my family. I've discovered my passion, and I'm on my way to becoming a pharmacy technician.
Dual enrollment at Georgia's 22 technical colleges. Double the credit, half the time, zero the tuition. Learn more at doublethecredit.org.
This program on GPB is made possible in part by supporters of the Georgia High School Association, including the following.
Support for GPB comes from Georgia Farm Bureau Mutual Insurance. From front porches to back roads, down the street or around the block, Georgia Farm Bureau is there with the protection families need, whether it's home, auto or life insurance, or something more. Georgia Farm Bureau is dedicated to providing the right coverage to all the friends, families, and neighbors who make this state home. More at gfbinsurance.com. Georgia Farm Bureau, always the home team.
Welcome back. Getting ready to figure out who will be bound for the bends on the right-hand side of the bracket in 7A. North Gwinnett leading McEachern by the score of 24-10. Looks like the winner of this one will get Colquitt County. Bonus coverage tonight on a 4th-and-3 from the 23. handoff, Nick Burge, up the middle, touchdown. Rome blows out Buford 45-7, and it could be the biggest loss since losing to Duluth 44 years ago. We're having to do some math. It is their worst loss in 27 years. It might be Buford's worst loss in 44, and Matt, the math that we did earlier, the run of consecutive state title game appearances for Buford ends at 10.
Wow. And the unconfirmed report that the Georgia Tech Seismology Lab recorded an earthquake there in Rome as the ground split open with Buford being beaten 45-7 tonight. Malik Evans, play action fake, dropping back to pass, throwing deep. He's got a man out there in complete triple coverage. Ali Scott was the intended target, and that was DJ Turner back there, along with two other guys. He was the third guy.
I think Rome made a statement tonight. They beat them 16-7 a year ago.
Yep.
But boy, this year, wow. That was a statement.
A 12-play drive that ends on downs, and North Gwinnett starts at their own 37-yard line.
Urzua looking over a four-man front, four backers.
Crosby on the play. Cameron Butler, that was two. Cameron Butler, who picked up six on the play. You've got a nice tandem of running backs there. Tyler Goodson does most of the heavy lifting, but you got a nice 2-3 punch with Cameron Butler and Devin Crosby as your two and three backs. That's Cunningham in motion.
You can't spy on him all the time anyway. There's
Butler,
another good run.
Picks up the first down. Going to be short by about a yard. Stopped at the 46, a yard short. Third and one coming up. And now McEachern's going to, I think they're going to get a steady dose of running between the tackles right here as North Gwinnett tries to drain the clock out in this fourth quarter.
Yep.
Third and one from the 46-yard line.
Do the Indians have it in them right here to make a big third down stop?
Need to make a stop here. Stunt.
Toss. Goodson. First down for Goodson.
Wow.
Across the 50-yard line, Goodson.
Look at the
Nathaniel way Dent made the tackle.
Look at the way Goodson just lowered that left shoulder when he turned the corner. Watch Goodson on the toss sweep. Zone blocking, found a gap, and just lowered his head, picked up the first down. This is a good, good running back, folks.
Powerful 5'10", 175 junior. It's first and 10 for North Gwinnett with the ball at the 49-yard line. Oops, Butler runs right into the teeth of the defense that time and loses a couple of yards on the play. Jeffrey Clark made the tackle.
As an offensive lineman, that's embarrassing on this side of the ball when your back gets jammed like that and you're turning around trying to still block the guy and help him out. No help needed there.
Second down and 12, ball back on the other side of the 50 now. Play clock at 10. Let's see. They're going to run that thing down. Let's see how far they take it.
Are they playing clock here already?
They are. Urzua, heavy rush, stands in there, fires downfield, and Cunningham, who's already had two big plays tonight, couldn't make a third right there, and it's third down.
That was kind of a surprise, wasn't it?
Well, they're going to take a shot right there and try to put the game away.
Yeah.
But it did break from what they were doing, but maybe they felt like they had kind of lulled the Indians into a pattern defensively of running between the tackles.
Obviously.
McEachern was looking for it. It's third down and 12. This is a big third down conversion coming up for this McEachern defense and an opportunity to get off the field and get their offense back on the field. They're down two touchdowns.
Crossing pattern on the left side from downs.
Urzua to the far sideline. It is caught and close to a first down. flag out, too. Maynor made the grab, falling out of bounds. Let's see where they spot it. I think it's the 39, but there's also a flag down at the 37 that came out after Maynor caught the ball and fell out of bounds.
We have really gotten into a flag fest here in the second half, haven't we?
I'm not exactly sure what this one's about because
I think it's pushing off. It may be on the offense. I'm not sure.
I think you're right. Just judging the reactions of the players.
Yeah, I'm seeing some jumping up and down there, which is not happy jumping up and down.
Pass interference on the offense.
Yeah,
15 yards from the previous spot. Replay. Third down.
And that will negate the 11-yard pickup that was close to the first down. And that's going to back him up to the 34-yard line with the line to gain the 39, the other 39.
When they ran that play, they had Downs and the other receiver on this side crossing each other, going deep. We may see a repeat of this. His choice may be to Mr. Downs this time. Same formation this time.
Urzua got a pocket. Ball out, and it's scooped up by McEachern. Still loose. Let's see who's on top of it. And Dante Fleming's got it at the 5-yard line.
Wow. It's never over till it's over, is it? What a break for McEachern.
Erickson was in there to pass protect. He got Moon down, but I think that was Burroughs who sacked Urzua and led to the fumble.
Wow.
Is it 96 Burroughs right here or 56?
56.
No, it's 96.
96.
Burroughs.
Okay.
Burroughs, the fumble, the forced fumble on the quarterback sack, and now McEachern back in business with lots of time on the clock.
Yep. Could be a game changer right there, Matt.
Paris Brown going to take direct snap. And Paris Brown fights forward for a yard to the four.
Paris Brown, tackled by number four, Burrell, assisted by
Warren Burrell made that tackle. Second down and goal from the four. That is the fourth turnover for North Gwinnett tonight. Can you win a state semifinal game with four turnovers?
We're about to find out, aren't we? Touchdown.
And we're about to find out if McEachern's on the comeback trail. 4-yard touchdown run by Paris Brown makes it 24-16.
Amazing.
Your TCSG touchdown replay following the fumble recovery took him two plays. Paris Brown right into the end zone. What a night for Paris Brown.
Just when you think North Gwinnett had captured the momentum of the game, a disastrous fumble.
And you think about the turn of events as Rodriguez puts it through to make it 24-17. And we'll talk about the sequence that led to this touchdown when we get back. Paris Brown cuts it to a touchdown with another big, strong touchdown run for the junior.
The Georgia Department of Agriculture, informing growers and the consuming public of new federal produce safety rules in Georgia. Full information about the new rules is available at georgiafarmsafety.com.
Regions Bank is always looking for opportunities to help communities and individuals move forward. In addition to offering financial solutions to our customers, we're committed to supporting local initiatives and organizations that help our neighborhoods thrive. Regions is proud to partner with Georgia Public Broadcasting in building a better Georgia.
Diverse Power is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
Yeah, just 8:29 to play in regulation. North Gwinnett's lead has been cut to 24-17. Four turnovers for the Bulldogs tonight have kept the Indians in this game.
And this was the fumble by Tyler Goodson. And then just a few moments ago, Urzua fumbled, scooped up by Dante Fleming, taken inside the five-yard line, and then two plays later, the touchdown run by Paris Brown.
Yeah.
And you mentioned it earlier. That's two scoring drives of 5 and 6 yards for McEachern in this game.
Right.
So North Gwinnett has kept them in the game and given them the opportunity to make the comeback. You mentioned that they had the big comeback against Lowndes, and it's picked up at the 10-yard line by Cunningham as McEachern decides to kick deep that time with, guess what, better results. They start at the 20.
Yeah, and they almost deep kicked that time. It was a line drive kick, so let's see what happens here now. North Gwinnett's got to remount and reload here. They got to get back focused again.
Well, it all goes back to the penalty that looked like they had picked up the first down on the pass completion.
Yeah.
But then the penalty backed them up, and then they found themselves throwing on third down and long, and that led to the fumble and eventually two plays later the touchdown.
Right.
Pass thrown, complete the downs, down, spin move, and Folks makes the tackle at the 21-yard line. A pickup of only one on the play.
Yeah. They've got to get him isolated one-on-one out there instead of the little hitch pass. They got to break him down the field. He's got good speed, runs great patterns, and they've got to get him open and get the ball to him. I think McEachern's going to just be pinning their ears back on defense here.
Handoff goes to Goodson, and Goodson rumbles up to the 26-yard line. Tony Davis, the rover, making the tackle, and it's going to bring up third down and four.
All of a sudden, what had seemed to be a quick-moving game is now...
Well, it appeared that North Gwinnett was in prime position just to drain the clock, and they were doing that successfully as long as they were able to run the ball, but then they had a couple of penalties, and then disaster happened.
Right.
Urzua, heavy rush, throws across the middle, incomplete, flag out. That's going to be a penalty on McEachern.
Yep.
Maynard the target, and Tony Davis made contact with him with the ball in the air.
No doubt about that one. People went flying through the air on that one.
Pass interference.
First down.
15 yards. Results of the first down.
Take a look at this. This is high pressure defense here, folks. Trust me.
15 penalties now on McEachern for 122 yards. So we asked the question about the Bulldogs. Can you get to the state championship game with four turnovers? Can you get to the state championship game when you commit 15 penalties?
I don't know. Time will tell on both of those counts.
We're 7 minutes away from getting an answer for that.
Yeah, we are.
That was Goodson on the carry. Very little gain for Tyler Goodson. McEachern's defense has done a really good job on Goodson tonight. They've made him earn all of his yards, 74 of them now, on 18 carries.
McEachern staying with the four-man front, four backers, three deep.
Butler on the carry. Cameron Butler tackled at the ankles by Dante Fleming.
He's a little more of a jitterbug runner, little quicker step. He's not your strider. But boy, Goodson is. What an opportune time for him to break one here.
Third and four for the Bulldogs here. Ball at the 48. Line to gain is the other 48. About halfway through this fourth quarter. Urzua in the pocket, fires incomplete, looking for the slant in the middle to Downs, and it's going to be fourth down.
He had some pressure. Had to get rid of it, I think, a little before he really wanted to. Had the right guy at the right place. The slant has been open all night long. Are they going for it?
I would doubt that.
He was looking at the sidelines, asking.
So Will Reichert stands to punt.
Colquitt County leading Brookwood 31-14 in the fourth quarter. Winner of this game plays the winner of that one for the 7A state title next Saturday in Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Line drive kick right into the hands of Hull at the 29-yard line. Hull right up the middle. Jerron Hull across the 50 makes a dead cut to the outside at the 43, and flag is dropped at the 47. 25-yard punt, 30-yard return.
Wow. Line drive kicks will get you in trouble, too.
But let's check the flag. If it's on McEachern, it's penalty number 16 on them tonight.
Flag down.
I can hardly remember a play in the second half where something hasn't been called.
During the return, there's a block in the back on the return team.
Yeah,
10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
So the 16th penalty on the Indians. We'll see where they spot the ball. Looks like it's going to be back at the 43.
Yeah.
If that was the penalty, that was very close to not being a penalty.
Very close, man. Very close.
The keeper takes over first and 10.
First and 10, ball at the 43. Indians 57 yards away from the end zone. Ball is thrown, and it is caught by Genuine Potts. Four guys trying to get him on the ground. They still haven't yet, and Potts keeps moving the pile down to the 31. Watch out. Here comes McEachern again.
And the crowd across the way is back into the game yet again. Good throw. Good catch.
Is this that magical season for McEachern? Is this the year they finally get back to the state finals? They've been once. That was in 1998 when A.J. Suggs led them to the state title game.
Wow.
Jalen Thornton gets thrown to the ground by, you guessed it, Jaden McDonald.
Wow. I shudder to think where this North Gwinnett defense would be tonight without young Mr. McDonald and his performance this night. Goodness gracious, that is just, that's what you call calf rope and bulldogging there. Wow.
He has had himself a game.
He has had that.
We're under five to play in regulation. Ball tipped at the line of scrimmage and it hit Pucciarello, the linebacker, right in the face. He'll never have a better pick six opportunity than that.
He'll be talking about that years to come from now.
Except years from come from now, he made the catch.
Yeah.
You'll remember when I made that catch.
You didn't catch it. It hit you in the face bar.
Third down and 11.
Yeah. Important point of the game right here.
Handoff. Paris Brown got some room on the outside. Oh, my goodness. D.J. Turner came up from the defensive backfield and met him in the open field and slams him to the ground. It's fourth down.
I thought it was McDonald the way he hit him, but not. Wow.
That's D.J. Turner, plays free safety for the Bulldogs. He's the number 24 rated cornerback in the nation in the class of 2019. He's just a junior. 23 offers for that young man already.
He'll get 24 or 25 after tonight.
Fourth down, Indians going for it. Line to gain is the 22. Evans going to fire out here for Brown. He can't hold on to it. Slips right out of his fingertips, and the ball goes over on down.
Wow.
Also take over, first and 10.
Yep.
Watch Jaden McDonald. No one blocked him, so Evans had to get rid of the ball maybe a split second quicker than he wanted to. Led Paris Brown a little bit too much, although Brown got his fingertips on it. And now the Bulldogs take over with 4 minutes and 3 seconds on the clock and leading by a touchdown.
To be sure, they will run clock here with a seven-point lead on the ball.
Handoff goes to Butler. Cameron Butler form tackle right there at the 28-yard line. Might have lost a yard on that play as Butler is slow to get off the ground. That's not Butler that's slow to get up. That's one of their offensive linemen.
That's one of those big offensive linemen up there.
The left tackle, Justin Bullock.
Yep. Boy, I tell you what, those guys have really done a good job up front.
3 minutes, 51 seconds to play. North Gwinnett with a touchdown lead. They've got the ball on offense when we get back.
Flint Energies is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is made possible in part by Regions Bank, helping you move forward with your life. Georgia's Electric Membership Corporation, so much more than electricity. Technical College System of Georgia, meaningful careers start here. Cigna, together all the way. And viewers like you, thank you.
If you text while driving, it's like turning the wheel over to your dear old grandpa, your nosy neighbor, your nephew. No, the younger one. And on top of everything else, it's against the law. Heads up, Georgia. Texting and driving is deadly on our roads. Put down the phone. Drive alert. Arrive alive.
As electric utility providers, Georgia's EMCs know how to generate and distribute electricity. But who are we really? We believe our brightest light shines from the cooperative principles we were founded on. Each day, Georgia's 41 EMCs provide safe, affordable, and reliable electricity to our members. But we serve our communities in additional ways, too. So whether you spot us around town or on your doorstep, know that your locally owned EMC is hard at work for you. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
With 3,300 members in Georgia, Local Union 72 is a growing resource for plumbing and mechanical workers with educational programs for those looking for a career. For over 125 years, union members have pursued the goals of safety and excellence while utilizing apprenticeship programs to advance the skills of plumbers, pipe fitters, welders, and HVAC technicians. Local Union 72, a proud sponsor of high school football on GPB.
.351 to play. North Gwinnett on offense trying to burn out the clock here. Second down and 10. They lead by a touchdown. McEachern just moments ago gave the ball up on downs. Handoff goes to Goodson, and Goodson got tripped up. That was a nice tackle down on the ground. Dante Fleming was on the ground, reached up with his hands and clicked his ankles and got him on the ground.
North Gwinnett now with 164 in rushing and 138 in passing. Well-balanced attack so far tonight by North Gwinnett.
Keep an eye on the play clock. Let's see. They're going to run that thing down as far as they can. There's 11 on the clock right now. Game clock at 3:06. It's third down. Urzua, pump fake, heavy rush, lobs it up in the air, jump ball, caught at the 50-yard line by Tyler Goodson. Was that the nail in the coffin? 18-yard pickup on third down, a fresh set of downs for the Bulldogs.
Throw it up, let the athlete do what he does. Goodson with a great play. He was looking for him the entire way. There was nobody else in the pattern that he was looking for.
First and 10, ball at the 50, 10 on the play clock. Urzua watching the play clock, waiting for the snap. They hand off to Butler. Cameron Butler picks up only two on that play. Tony Davis making the tackle. And timeout, I believe, called by McEachern. That'll leave them with one. All right, finals now from John Nelson as we're filling up the dance card for Mercedes-Benz Stadium.
And we'll analyze it in the postgame show, so don't go anywhere after this 2:25, and I'll use the R word. Regulation gets taken away from us here. Winner of this one gets Colquitt County, 31-14 winners over Brookwood tonight. Big touchdown run by Dejan Edwards seals the deal for Colquitt County and Region 1-7A. You know, the entire town of Moultrie and the entire county will be up at the Benz taking on either North Gwinnett or McEachern. In 6A, Coffee knocks off Tucker 14-3, so Robbie Pruitt and the Trojans, everyone from Douglas, will be making their way up from South Georgia for primetime on Friday night. And they will take on the winner of Glen Academy and Lee County. That's the only other game currently in play. Lee County was down. They have come all the way back. They lead by four with 3 minutes to go. Regulation back upstairs.
All right. One timeout remaining for McEachern. So basically, North Gwinnett needs just one more first down to put this game away. Second down and 7.5. Handoff Goodson. Bulls his way forward down to the 43. That's going to bring up a third down and 3. Let's see if McEachern burns timeout here. And they do.
They do, yes.
So this is the play of the game right here.
Yep, 2:12 left in regulation, as we like to say. But do you have a defensive stop left in you? I tell you what, this has been just a back-and-forth momentum here in the second half. Unbelievable, some of the things that have happened to North Gwinnett offensively, which really has hurt them a lot.
Well, we're down to a 3rd-and-3 with 2 minutes and 12 seconds left. If McEachern picks up the first down, if North Gwinnett picks up the first down, the game is over. If McEachern gets the stop here, they're probably going to have to stop them again on fourth down.
What I like about Coach Stewart is he doesn't have a headphone on. He's letting his offensive coordinator call the plays. I think he's giving him a few suggestions, wouldn't you think?
I would think. But I'm guessing here this is four down territory likely for North Gwinnett.
If you
don't pick up the first down, you're probably going to run it again and try to pick up the first down and end the game.
Well, if you do the right thing, you'll run straight ahead. You won't go side to side here running the ball. There's always that chance of getting thrown for a loss, but you need to just go straight ahead. You got to have good blocking up front, and you got to have that good zone blocking where they move 1 foot to the right or 1 foot to the left, and everybody follows. Let's see what they do here.
Third down and 3. Game right here for McEachern. Direct snap to Goodson. First down and more. There goes Tyler Goodson. Good night. Game over.
Amen, brother. Excellent blocking up front by that North Gwinnett line of scrimmage. What a gash this late in the game. That was a gash, folks.
43-yard touchdown run. North Gwinnett is going to Mercedes-Benz Stadium to play Colquitt County for the 7A state championship. 13 consecutive wins for Bill Stewart's team since dropping the opener at Corky Kell Classic against Walton. And a disappointing finish for a McEachern team that overachieved this year. They weren't even expected to get this far in what was supposed to be a rebuilding season for the Indians. They will finish at 10-4. PAT by Clark is good. Here's your TCSG touchdown replay.
Watch the big guy over the ball. Watch this movement. There's your hole right there, folks. He collapsed the front part of the McEachern line of scrimmage. Hopefully, we've got a shot of that at ground level. I'd love to see that again. Watch this. Boom. There you go, folks. That's the way you do it up front. And that's the way you run it to the end zone.
43-yard touchdown run for the nail in the coffin. Tyler Goodson with the exclamation point on this North Gwinnett victory. They just needed a first down. He gave them a touchdown. A 6-play, 71-yard drive to finish it off. Tyler Goodson and the North Gwinnett Bulldogs are going to the 7A state championship game. It'll be the third state championship game in North Gwinnett history as Goodson on that run goes up over 100 yards, 21 carries for 125 and a touchdown.
A 5 and a 55 made that happen. Erickson, the center, who has played double duty tonight. Boy, he has been something tonight, offensively and defensively.
Kick return by Nikoi Morris. And the Indians go back on offense for a final time tonight and this season. You see the disappointment on that McEachern Indians bench over there. But like I said before, they exceeded expectations this year, replacing a star-studded lineup that had been in the semifinals in 2013, 2014, had made deep runs in the playoffs the years after that. Nothing to hang their heads about here. Isaiah Lee will take over at quarterback. They will run a reverse, and that was Evans. I thought they were going to run a reverse. It ends up being a toss back to Malik Evans. He falls incomplete.
Mr. Goodson has had a good night. It's not been one of those stellar nights, but boy, he put the nail in the coffin, didn't he?
Packed house, you're right. Packed house here at Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium. They'll get to take their Santa Claus gear, Christmas gear, to Mercedes-Benz Stadium next week. It's been Santa Claus Christmas night here on the first Friday night of December.
And a good present for this community.
Indeed. McDonald steals it away. Jaden McDonald to the end zone for the touchdown.
Wow.
Well, that's fitting.
That is fitting.
It's been a spectacular night for Jaden McDonald. Stole the ball right out of Brandon Christie's hands for the touchdown. Ball out, brother.
Let me tell you something. If you want to see a football player, take a look at number 8, my friends. That's a football player.
Wow.
Wow is right. He has put on one show tonight.
Had him some beast mode tonight. 37-17.
Tell you what, you got to be a pretty good football player to bump with him even on the sidelines, don't you? You better be in shape. Great effort by the young man.
Clark with the PAT. And the final score is not going to be indicative of this game. The TCSG touchdown replay. Jaden McDonald with the theft. And the touchdown.
I got the ball. You got nothing. I got a touchdown. This one's over.
24 yards. I assume that goes down as a fumble. Yeah, it's got to be a fumble
recovery. It's got to be a fumble recovery.
Yeah.
I don't think it was really fumbled.
Our official statistician, Kevin Barnes, he's trying to say it's an interception.
Interception? Okay. Hey, you're the man with the pencil. You know. Yeah, it is a North Gwinnett Bulldog touchdown.
Wow. North Gwinnett and Colquitt County for the state championship next Saturday night on GPB. We'll have 8 games for you next week. Friday and Saturday, 4 on Friday, 4 on Saturday. It all starts at 11 a.m. on Friday with the single-A private state championship.
How many people in the state of Georgia would you think would have bet that Colquitt County and North Gwinnett would be the two teams playing in the Mercedes-Benz Stadium for the championship? Both of them supposedly in rebuilding years.
So, yeah, you're right. I mean, North Gwinnett not expected to be here. I think they were ranked number 5 in the final regular season rankings. Colquitt County, they played 5 straight weeks on the road. I mean, they should have rented themselves a condominium complex here in Atlanta.
Yeah.
They've spent 5 straight weeks here. Well, 4 straight. Next week will be 5.
Yeah.
They should have made the investment. I mean, they've been on the road the entire playoffs as the number 3 seed out of Region 1. And they'll be coming back to Atlanta again. But they know that road trip.
They know the road trip.
They don't even have to use MapQuest.
No, they don't. They know the itinerary, don't they?
They know where to go.
Yep, they sure do.
Another little pooch kick.
One of Matt's new favorites.
And McEachern going to toss the ball around. They're going in reverse. Now they throw it all the way across the field and fall down at the 13-yard line.
Oh, no.
Now you got, they were trying something there, and you can see they've worked on that in practice.
Sure. And at this point, you do anything you make. You can. What's Coach Stewart saying here now?
You got to love what he's been able to do here, following in the footsteps of Bob Spire. They've won 13 in a row now with this victory here tonight. Was the defensive coordinator at Mill Creek the last 2 years. He knows very well about that Colquitt County team, so he's very familiar with going up against Colquitt County.
Yep. I love it when they have a guy that's holding on to the shirt, you know, or holding on to the jacket. Get back on the field.
Delay a game here.
Offense, 5-yard penalty.
Well, I mean, Bill Stewart's just telling his guys to get back. He's saying, you just drop back. Don't let anybody get behind you.
True. I think he's calling defenses, isn't he?
He's saying, get back. Don't let anybody get behind you. It's time to finish this one off. 1:42 to play, and North Gwinnett is blowing it open here. They're going to run some razzle-dazzle. Might give up some more points if they're not careful. We got holding back there in the end zone. And if there's holding in the end zone, that could be a safety, I believe.
Yeah, could be.
Personal foul. Nope. Face mask. Defense. 15 yards from the end of the run. First down.
Okay.
So they'll bring the ball out to the 30-yard line.
15-yard penalty. Face mask.
We'll be with you bright and early Friday morning for the start of the state championships at Mercedes-Benz. Genuine Potts making the grab for McEachern out there on the edge. And John Nelson sticking around for the postgame show coming up. He's going to run through all the matchups for you. Coming up in just a few minutes.
The amazing thing about McEachern is they never give up. They never just say it's over.
Intercepted. Ball goes over again as this game has come off the rails.
Yep.
Miles Webster with the interception, but what this does allow us to do now is for North Gwinnett to take a knee and finish
take
this game off.
Finish it over. No get more pooch over. Kicks. Yeah. None of that. And
get it over with.
Yeah. Good defense. Good defense by North Gwinnett.
So now the coronation begins as the Bulldogs take the victory formation with 1 minute and 8 seconds left on the clock. And can you believe, with 3 minutes left in this game, we were still talking about the possibility of there being an overtime.
I know. In regulation, we use that term more than once.
Because the possibility was right there. McEachern had a chance. They gave the ball up on downs, and then things got out of hand over the final 3 minutes of this game. And North Gwinnett's going to win it 38-17.
Yeah.
So the 7A state championship game, North Gwinnett and Colquitt County. North Gwinnett state championship appearances came in 2007. They lost to Lowndes down there. That's back before they were playing in Atlanta, the state title games.
Right.
And in 2013, they lost to Norcross in the now defunct Georgia Dome.
Yep.
And Colquitt County's back in the state championship game after winning it back-to-back years in 2014 and 2015. Knocked out in the quarters last year by Grayson. Guess what? Rush Probst has his team back.
And told me in an interview this summer,
we're not going to be really good this year, but you better get us this year because we're going to be really good from now on after this year.
Now, you know you can't believe anything Rush says.
Of course, I believe everything the man says there. We'll be lucky to win six games this year, he told me, Matt.
Rush, Probst, and the Colquitt County Packers can start doing their film work for the North Gwinnett Bulldogs. That'll be their opponent next Saturday at 8 o'clock. Scheduled kickoff time at Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Congratulations to the Bulldogs. Winners now of 13 in a row.
Wow.
In Bill Stewart's first season as the head coach, they'll take a 13-1 record into Mercedes-Benz Stadium to play Colquitt County. McEachern season comes to a close at 10-4. Tyler Goodson, 21 carries for 125 yards and a touchdown. Jimmy Urzua, 12 for 18 passing for 156. Spoiled a really good night by Paris Brown, who ended up rushing for 161 yards in a losing effort for McEachern. Let's send it down to Sam Crenshaw.
Good with Coach Stewart. This way, just a little bit. Congratulations, Coach. You and your team are going to Mercedes-Benz Stadium.
Yes, sir. Yeah. It's a great feeling, man. I mean, this kid's been doing it all year, and what a testament to, you know, their character and just putting it together and playing like a family. So I'm very proud of them.
I saw you on the sideline. They had just scored. McEachern had scored, made it 24-17. You came over and told your defense, this is our game. Yeah. This is still our game. We're going to keep fighting and going to finish.
Yeah. So at that moment, I mean, you have to be able to you know, just continue to be composed and knowing that, you know, they're a great football team, and so they're playing right here. So.
Okay. Well, congratulations. We'll see you next week at Mercedes-Benz.
Okay, great, man. Thanks.
All right. That is Coach Bill Stewart.
Postgame show now underway from Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium in Suwanee. North Gwinnett was up only by 7. They win by 21 after the game kind of tilts sideways in the fourth quarter. North Gwinnett makes it to the Benz. And we now know, Nikki, the 16 teams that will be playing.
See,
she's like Snidely Whiplash.
Well, I kind of feel like I have a little bit of whiplash that game. If you'll forgive me, it was like you were in a ping pong machine.
And that was the way that they wanted it. So 38-17, your final score. North Gwinnett makes it. They will play Colquitt County in the 7A title game. That will be your primetime game, the last game on the board on Saturday night at Mercedes-Benz. And let's take a look at how we got to this moment in time here with North Gwinnett getting the Duke. And this one was close early. Fumbles end up creating a short field for McEachern. Paris Brown, who had a big night in a losing cause, had 160 yards. North of that, made it 7-0, and then John Urzua with the keeper on the RPO, the run-pass option. He'll hang on to it. You're going to see a lot of plays more than once, like this one. Unbelievable catch, which sets up the fade right here at the end of the half, 14-7 at the break. Then North Gwinnett Urzua throws the slider low and away. Catch on the slant route. Points on the board make it 21-7, but McEachern would not give up. 24-10 as they trade field goals here. 24-17 once again. Paris Brown out of the Wildcat. And it was a one-score game. Then, hey, you want Wildcat? I'll give you Wildcat. Up the middle, McEachern sells out for the run. You get to the second level. It ends up for a score. And then you have the steal and score here. Watch this. Jaden McDonald right there with the grab and go. You want to talk about going through the drive-through window. That was how it went there, and that was your final score of the night. And that was your final score for North Gwinnett, as North Gwinnett gets the Duke over McEachern, and they make it through. And they have won every single game since losing their first one this season.
Let me just tell you, I don't know how we just got a highlight reel out of that. The whole game was a highlight reel. How many turnovers? How many penalties?
5 and a lot.
Well, you know what? Everybody was working really hard during this game, but only one can be the Union 72
yep.
hardest working player of the game.
And we're
going
to give it to?
As no surprise. Are you ready? North Gwinnett's number 7, Urzua. What didn't he do tonight?
Jimmy Urzua with the big run there and the throw. and the fade. So Jimmy Urzua, hardest working player of the game from our friends at Union 72. Had a lot of contenders there, and you're over at the big board again, aren't you?
It's where I like to go, John. I like to head over to the big board after we talk about the big plays and the big players. And then we talk about the fans on social media, or in this case, the players. Guess who is bound for the bins? They all know it. They're looking good. They're celebrating. Also bound for the bins. It's the players, it's the band, it's the cheerleaders, it's the whole school headed towards the bins. They are so excited, and I'm so glad you guys took time out of your celebrations to tweet us and Instagram us and Facebook us and Snapchat us, because we want to see your excitement. And you know, we've been using bound for the bins this whole time, but I think we need to switch it up a little bit, because now we're going to the bins. So let's check out our new hashtags. Be in the bins, wins in the bins. Ooh, that was really creative with those Z's. In the bins, blitz in the bins. We are really creative over here, guys. So use our new hashtags when you guys are following us and hanging out with us on social media. And make sure you download that GPB Sports app so you don't have to miss a second. John?
iPhone and Android available now for the GPB Sports app. And for those of us with Android phones, that is a very cool thing. It was a good addition for us this year when it comes to the GPB Sports app. Let's take a look at the play of the game. We had a couple of contenders, kind of like we did for the player of the game. Could have gone a couple of different ways. So what we decided to do was go one on offense and one on defense. The grab there on the pick defensively. We'll show it again. Watch the grab one-handed and hanging on to it. You gotta love the sticky gloves these days. So that was the defensive version. Here's the offensive version. You saw it with Jimmy Urzua winding up, and why not? Look at this. That's just nuts. Absolutely insane. One more look at it. One hand, one grab, two plays. Play of the game, one on offense and one on defense. And that is it for the early part of the postgame show. We come back, we'll go through brackets, we'll let you see what's going on. We'll see who is going to hashtag be in the bins, the postgame show from Tom Robinson Memorial Stadium in Suwanee. North Gwinnett, we know in 7A, will fill out your brackets when we come back. Final score, North Gwinnett wins by 21. Stick and stay, more when we come back.
We are the TV doctors of America, and we may not know much about medicine,
but we know a lot about drama.
From scandalous romance
to ridiculous plot twists.
Son?
Dad.
We also know you can avoid drama by getting an annual checkup.
So we're partnering with Cigna to remind you to go see a real doctor.
Go, know, and take control of your health.
It could save your life.
Doctor poses.
Dad.
Cigna, together all the way.
Georgia's EMCs are committed to more than power. We're committed to staying power. In our 80-year history as an anchor of the community, we've weathered good times and challenging times right here with you. And we continue to invest in programs that energize our communities through hands-on learning and charitable giving, helping the next generation rise above, speed ahead, and power on. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
On the first day of college, I was already a sophomore. I earned 32 college credits through the dual enrollment program at my local technical college. Cool part is, they all transferred. I saved time, and I saved my parents a lot of money.
Dual enrollment at Georgia's 22 technical colleges. Double the credit, half the time, zero the tuition. Learn more at doublethecredit.org.
Join the conversation on GPB Radio every day from 5 a.m. to 7 p.m. on 88.5 FM in Atlanta. Or tune in to one of our network of stations across the state. GPB News, empowering you one story at a time.
Grady EMC is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
Welcome back to Suwanee. We're going to fill out the brackets and let you see who is going to hashtag be in the bins for the championships, the 2017 version of the Tommy Gillibeau GHSA Football Championships that you will see all weekend long starting bright and early Friday morning. And I know that we're supposed to bring Nikki donuts, and if I don't, I'm probably going to be indicted for it. So I know that I've got to bring breakfast. I'm the one responsible for it. So let's fill out your brackets. We'll start 7A, work our way down, and Nikki and Sam will join us in just a sec. So we know what happened in our half of the bracket with McEachern and North Gwinnett. You saw that one here on Georgia Public Broadcasting, advancing North Gwinnett, and they will play Colquitt County. Colquitt County comes all the way through as the 3 seed, knocking off Pebble Brook, going on the road. You'll notice a trend. Going on the road, going on the road, going on the road, going on the road. Colquitt County, North Gwinnett, that is your matchup on prime time for Saturday in the 7A bracket. So Colquitt County, North Gwinnett, that's your championship game here on GPB on Saturday night. So let's go to 6 and fill out the bracket here. Left-hand side of the bracket, you can advance Coffee. The Trojans working their way past Tucker, winning 14-3. They move on. Robbie Pruitt comes to a championship game in the state of Georgia, has a lot of championships in the state of Florida, now gets to do one in Georgia. Everyone from Douglas, we know you're going to show up, and they will play Lee County. Lee County comes all the way back from being down at one point, 38-24. They come back to 38-21. They come back to win 42-38. So Coffee and Lee County, that's your matchup prime time in Friday night's action. So it's Douglas versus Leesburg in the 6A bracket prime time on Friday. Now let's take it 5A and let's see what happened here. Here's how it looked. We showed you bonus coverage all night with Roman Buford. Rome all the way through. Big effort again offensively, led by Knox Kadem at quarterback, and they will play Warner Robbins, who handled Carver Atlanta. Two great football towns going at it in the 5A championship game. Rome and John Reed chasing after back-to-back titles. Warner Robbins, Mike Chastain, they were 3-7 last year. Dylan Fromm at quarterback put up a lot of numbers offensively, so it's Rome and Warner Robbins in your 5A title game. So that means we slide to 4. Show you what's going on here. Marist put up big numbers tonight against St. Pius, so Marist advances. They move on, and they will play Blessed Trinity. Blessed Trinity clamped down on Mary Persons down in Forsyth, so it is Marist and Blessed Trinity going at it. Blessed Trinity, Coach Tim McFarland, lost to Westminster in a title game 2 years ago, and it is Air Marist. Air Marist, young man, Chase Absher, quarterback, who can both run and throw for Alan Chadwick. Marist and Blessed Trinity right there in Quad A. So, once again, Marist with Alan Chadwick, we always had that 7-foot staff that he would throw and expect to drop it between the back ankle of the quarterback and his A-back, because that was what he wanted to run the veer. Marist and Blessed Trinity is going to be your title game. And really, this one could be about an hour and a half by the time this game is done, because both these teams are going to run the football. I'm going to send it over to my right and let folks discuss what we've seen so far. Nikki?
Could you hear me over there beating on my chair?
Yes, I could.
I'm so excited Coffee and Lee County. Guys, we're talking about a team that has not even made it as far as the semis since 1981. That's when Aquanet was all the rage. I don't even know about that.
Aquanet.
And then we're talking about Lee County that has never advanced this far in their school's history, and they're going to play. I'm sorry, my heart is full, guys. It is full.
With some first-timers, some that have been there in a while, and then you got places like Warner Robbins. Welcome back to the Demons. Used to be a fixture in the state championships for years. They're back now, and I think the last time they played in the Dome, a former Warner Robbins player who was a quarterback, who was the governor at that time, was at the game. Sonny Perdue.
That would have been a Sonny Perdue.
Yeah.
Interesting point. We talked to Coach Mike Chastain earlier in the year. He was the offensive coordinator for young Jake Fromm, who is now at Georgia. And he says that this edition of Rom is better than Jake.
Wow.
So we get an opportunity to see it in the Dome next week. I mean, not in the Dome, but in Mercedes-Benz.
Oh, we're going to start a jar for that. We're going to start a jar for that.
They're
going to
meet you
quarters
at the door. They will meet you at the door. You got to get it right.
I know they'll
you
meet
know
me at the door. Hey, when you implode, you implode. That's all I got to say.
Oh, my gosh. Guys, when we come back, hang with us. We're going to fill out the rest of those brackets. So don't go anywhere. Hang with us on our post-game show.
Greystone Power is a proud sponsor of high school football on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
If you text while driving, it's like turning the wheel over to your dear old grandpa. your nosy neighbor, your nephew, no, the younger one. And on top of everything else, it's against the law. Heads up, Georgia. Texting and driving is deadly on our roads. Put down the phone. Drive alert. Arrive alive.
For many teens, the freedom of driving can come at a terrible price, as vehicle crashes remain the leading cause of death for teens in America. The Ford Motor Company Fund is dedicated to ending these tragedies. Our Ford Driving Skills for Life Academy is a free online driving program for teen drivers featuring advanced skills from professional instructors.
For more information, go to drivingskillsforlife.com. As a proud sponsor of the Georgia High School Football Playoffs on GPB, stay safe and enjoy the games.
Regions Bank is always looking for opportunities to help communities and individuals move forward. In addition to offering financial solutions to our customers, we're committed to supporting local initiatives and organizations that help our neighborhoods thrive. Regions is proud to partner with Georgia Public Broadcasting in building a better Georgia.
Whether behind the scenes, on the phone, or running the show, our volunteers bring GPB to life. To get involved, visit gpb.org/volunteer.
Welcome back to Suwannee. We're going to fill out the rest of our brackets here on the postgame show. North Gwinnett, we know they're going to be playing Colquitt County in the 7A title game primetime on Saturday here on the great GPB. But we're going to pick things up here in AAA. Two great football towns advance in AAA as well. Peach County goes to Greater Atlanta Christian. They get the Duke. So the Campbell brothers from Peach County. The Trojans go from Fort Valley, so it's going to be Fort Valley versus Calhoun. Calhoun knocks off Cedar Grove by the final of 14-6. Peach County holds off Greater Atlanta Christian 28-23. So AAA, Peach County and Calhoun. That's what it looks like. There's your roads to it. Peach County having to go to Norcross to knock off Tim Hardy and the Spartans. Calhoun knocking off the defending champs in Cedar Grove. So AA. Brooks County did the Tommy Palmer pack-a-lunch, pack-a-dinner trip, driving 280 miles to go to Tiger. But get this, Rabun County goes to their first ever title game. Lee Shaw went home a couple years ago, and Lee Shaw, Rabun County gets to appear against another first-timer in Hapeville Charter. Hapeville Charter scores with 5 seconds to go to knock off Heard County in Franklin. So Rabun County, the Wildcats, and Hapeville Charter, the Hornets. Two first-timers showing up here in the AA playoff bracket. Congrats to both sides. You know the entire town of Tiger is going to be there. Class A Public, I'll show you what happened here. Back-and-forth game. Clinch County comes out of the Region of Doom. Region 2 Single A. They get the win 23-20 over Mount Zion Carroll. Irwin County in an absolute shootout. Knocks off ECI, Clinch County, Irwin County, so Region of Doom. Two teams ranked top five all year long. Make it through. Clinch County and Irwin County in Class A Public. Now, Class A Private. This is going to be the first game that you will see on Friday, bright and early. Bring your breakfast. For Nikki, of course. I don't eat breakfast, so it's got to go to Nikki. The Class A Public game will be your first game on Saturday. Class A Private, Eagles Landing Christian. 55-0 winners over Prince Avenue. So Eagles Landing Christian, they've won 35 in a row. Jonathan Guess and the Chargers make it to another title game, and they will play Athens Academy. Athens Academy, this is a battle of 1-2 in the private playoff bracket. So this is 1-2 here. Athens Academy was down by the score of 7-0 to Mount Perrin Christian, but they come back for the Duke and win 14-7, so it's a battle of 1-2 in the power rankings, Eagles Landing Christian and Athens Academy. And I'm going to send it over to the guys and Nikki to kind of talk things through while I walk over simultaneously, and we kind of see what things are going to talk about here as we go. So I'm going to wander this way
okay.
and say hi.
Hey, how you doing?
I can could be a guy, right?
I said the guys
the
and Nikki.
Guys, right?
I said the guys and Nikki. No.
You'll never be mistaken for a guy.
I'll take that. That's fine. That's a compliment.
Okay,
thank
all right.
You.
So, legend, what do you think about the eight matchups?
I think we've got some great ones. First, starting with 7A, as I told Matt up in the booth, I don't think anybody in the state of Georgia would have predicted that North Gwinnett and Colquitt County would be meeting in the 7A finals, and I don't think anybody in the state of Georgia would have ever thought Rome would do to Buford tonight what they did to them in North Georgia.
No, sir. Sam, what do you think?
A lot of matchups. I'm looking forward to that Hateville Charter and Raven game. I think two teams in the state finals for the first time. I think it's going to be a lot of fun to watch. So that's one game I'm looking forward to.
I second you there. Let's take a look at what Friday is going to look like at the Benz. Like John said, you're going to have to get up bright and early as we kick things off. 10 a.m. Athens Academy versus Eagles Landing Christian. Peach County versus Calhoun at 1. Rome versus Warner Robins, 4:30. And guys, the one I am the most excited about, Coffee versus Lee
Coffee.
County, 8 p.m. Can
tremendous
you believe we're even looking
towns.
At that?
Yeah.
Friday. And then we move on to Saturday. Clinch County versus Irwin County kicking things off, 10 a.m. Raven County versus Hateville Charter. That's Sam's favorite right there. Marist versus Blessed Trinity, 4:30. And then that marquee matchup, Colquitt County versus North Gwinnett, 8 p.m.
And if you want to see the single wing, get there at 10 o'clock on Saturday morning. Clinch County still runs the single wing.
Pro
tip. So you're saying the game's going to be over by 10:45?
No, I'm not saying that at all.
So pack a sleeping bag.
John, tell me the thing I'm going to be looking forward to are these teams that are coming to play in this new facility.
Yes.
They've seen it on TV, but they haven't been there in person. Don't get caught looking up at that halo board.
They
my
will.
My goodness.
They
you know,
will.
They got to spend a little extra time walking around in that place before they play their games.
It's a little hotter. It's a little faster when it's under a dome. You know, and Hateville Charter, the fact that they go from the facilities that they have, or should I say don't have, into something like Mercedes-Benz, it's just going to be amazing to watch these kids and the fans and the bands and the cheerleaders. It's just going to be awesome.
I tell you something that I like about it. You've got folks from North Georgia, South Georgia, Middle Georgia. You got them from everywhere coming to play at a beautiful new place. And I'm not even going to say the dome. I'm going to say Mercedes-Benz.
You already, you already owe a quarter to the jar.
I know. I've already imploded once. I can apologize only once for that.
You know, the best thing about this is people all over the country will get to see high school football from Georgia. And, of course, around the world. That's the thing I really love about that weekend. I got a dear friend of mine that lives in California who's from Calhoun. She's going to be so fired up that she can go to gpb.org and watch her school in her hometown play. So that's a really cool thing about next weekend.
And we are trying to get to 15,000 and beyond on Twitter, 30,000 and beyond on Facebook. Be a part of that process as well. Follow along on Snapchat, Instagram, all those places. We have had a tremendous season outdoors, and we are heading to the Benz. You're going to see a list of folks coming up here in a sec, and they crush it every week to make sure that you get the best coverage of high school football all around the state of Georgia. So from Swanee, one last time outdoors before we head to the Benz. Play it safe, everybody. We'll see you at the Benz.